Here we go.
I'm doing good. How are you doing?
Live. Hi, Kamiko.
Sorry, I'm having a snack. Really fast eating some almonds.
Oh, good.
Put it on the wrong screen.
Oh, good. I had to eat my taco.
Ooh, tacos.
Mm-hmm.
I had leftover steak and mac and cheese.
Tarnoff.
Ooh, that sounds good.
That sounds delicious.
It was. It was
good. No idea what I'm having for dinner.
It was in Instapot mac and cheese, Corgi.
Ooh.
Yeah, she finally broke out the Instapot.
Except you can't do steak.
Well, no, we've used it before. She just, it hasn't been used. No, we didn't. No, we didn't do the steak in it, but we did the mac and cheese.
We tried to do a chili with the hamburger without searing it first, and it's a pot. That was a big fail.
It was good, Cam. It was very good.
Cook your steak in a frying pan before you throw it in the Instapot, or not steak, hamburger in the Instapot.
Mm-hmm.
Man, I messed it all up. Cook your hamburger in a pan first before you put it in Instapot to make chili. Got to toughen
that meat up. Doesn't your Instapot have a sauté mode?
Yeah, brown it up.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you got to brown it up and toughen it up. Sear it before you throw it in there because the Instapot, by the pressure,
you should be able to do it in the Instapot. You should be able to saute it in the Instapot before you pressure it.
That's true. I didn't think about that.
That's what I did with my soup.
That's true.
Toscana.
Yeah, how was your Tuscan soup?
It was delicious.
All right, so I think everybody's live, or at least getting there. Cammy goes there. How you doing, Cammy? Talking food. So what you have for dinner? That's the first question before we start anything.
That's it. What'd you have for dinner?
No matter what chat.
Stealing my sticks.
I had meatloaf.
Oh, nice. Yeah, we were going to have meatloaf.
Good. Meatloaf is real good. Oh, man. Now you got me craving some meatloaf.
Okay. title of the stream is...
Death House.
Death House.
I still think it should be something along the lines of, you know, Ed got knocked out by a broom.
Yeah, something
revive Tok.
Tok gets the floor swept with him.
Death by broom.
Do we really have to pick him up? I mean, he's resting.
Yeah, we gotta do a strength check on the pickup because I think he's pretty, you know, pretty.
Those aren't.
Well, best I can do, I can heal him.
It's breakfast. Coffee's good for breakfast. Cheers to coffee.
I can heal.
Cheers.
I mean, he is gonna, you know, be getting, you know, a lot of, you know, flack about, you know, getting knocked by a broom.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
We got an emote too. We got an emote in Discord.
Does he need to die?
There's a broom emote now in Discord.
You can give Tok all the flack you want. He's got big dragonborn shoulders. He could take it.
And especially laying down.
Yep.
Ain't that the truth?
That is the truth. Oh, how everybody doing? Our Friday night. Well, I was going to say Friday night Fright Night, but our Curse of Strahd.
Pretty close.
Yeah, session one. There was an old movie called Fright Night. I don't know if everybody remembers that. That was pretty.
Oh yeah,
pretty
yep.
Classic vampire movie. I was playing on the ideas of Friday Night, Fright Night.
Mm-hmm.
Welcome. Title should be Glorious Foods Chat. D&D is a bonus.
That's what I should just name all of mine.
That's
from now
it.
I
like
on
that.
Forever.
Yep.
That's always the problem with Corgi's thing. It's always like, hi, welcome to my thing. Now, what are you having for dinner?
Mm-hmm. Yep. What are you having? What are you eating? What you make?
Yep.
I swear, Corgi should have a cooking channel.
Actually,
at least a cooking chat channel.
It's an eating channel.
did you tell me what you had for dinner, Nail?
What did you have?
Oh yeah, Taco Bell. You were doing takeout.
I actually just got home like right, and then I set up my stream and everything like that. So I haven't even eaten it yet.
Oh.
Yeah, I went and got the wife some Lucky Sushi, so I got her a bowl and everything from the sushi place, and then me and the kids all got Taco Bell.
Ooh, I'll tell you what, it's hard to find a good sushi place. It really is.
He's around Meyer.
I mean, you don't live close to an ocean. Likes.
Yeah, I'd say Lisa Meyer anyways. If you can find a good sushi place, the sushi's really good, but people get turned off very easily about it. One, because it's raw fish, but two, it's probably had it paired wrong.
Oh man,
well, that's the problem with most things, though. People have it, you know, made wrong, and yep. It instantly turns them off to the rest of it, you know.
The Camico agrees to the cooking chat for corgis. Eh? That's two votes.
Absolutely.
Two votes.
Maybe one of these days I will just have a just chatting where we sit and we talk food, and that's
just chatting where you just talk about food. That's like the perfect channel for you.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Gonna have to set up like a channel in my Discord where we can post like recipes and then talk about them.
So there is a D&D cookbook. I mean, you could kind of work a D&D cooking channel.
There is.
They're actually just called Tabletop something or other, where they half of the episode is them cooking food for their tabletop session, and then they go into they do the whole thing for like first 12 minutes, and then they go into their tabletop session. It's interesting. It's a nice little hook.
It's like every single session of like I'm making dinner for my tabletop friends, and it's like I just take a piece of or a loaf of bread and slice it in half and throw a block of cheese on there, and it's done.
There you go. Tavern fare.
This is your roasted pheasant with mead.
Some watered down ale in a dirty mug.
Oh my gosh. Like that, like the beer that we got at that really sketchy bar.
the dive bar on the dark side of town there. Yeah.
Yeah, on our Saturday campaign, we were trying to find information out, and we went into, like, the sketchiest bar in the world.
That's awesome.
I know, man. Ed had a pretty tasty beer last night.
Yeah, nothing like this one, though. This one was, like, you know, like a half-ogre bartender spitting in the mug and cleaning it before you put your beer in it and hands it to you. It was fun.
It's got, like, floaties in it.
Yeah.
Sounds like
nice.
Smart.
Nice.
To be fair, Fortis loves that beer.
He does, actually.
He's had like 20 gold worth of that beer, at least.
Dang.
Go around for the house.
I still don't understand why one costs the same as four. I just don't understand that. It doesn't make sense to me.
Did you like my tactic with it, though, last night?
It's good, though, right?
Nice.
Yeah, Neil.
That's coming too. There's be Wednesday night sessions. There's a Thursday night bully DM in his custom world, Dragon's Rest, and then we got Friday night Curse of Strahd. So we got 3 days out of the week. We always got some kind of D&D content coming.
Yep.
But our cast of crew kind of changes here and there. We got basically everybody from our Wednesday session, which is Big Ed, Corgi, Bully, but we got Frizz, the new face in town. The frog.
That's me, Frizz.
Frizz. and he's playing Kurgle, the frog. I hope I pronounced it right. I'm going to have trouble with some of these names.
Kurgle. Think Captain Kirk. Kurgle.
Yeah, exactly what I was going to say.
The Q is sound like, you know, after an R, before an L, it's Q, but it's QL.
Don't.
Kurgle.
Don't read it.
We're not dealing with English phonetics, right? This is it, just think Kirkle.
If I go Kirkle, I'm gonna call him Kermit.
The funny thing is it's really easy for me because that's the way my son used to say circle when he was like 3 years old. It was Kermit.
That's cool.
That's so, fair. That's fair.
It's really easy for me to remember.
All right, so like I said, today's session one, even though we did kind of start last week, so we did get a little bit in to the so-called Death House. The question is tonight, can they escape Death House? We'll see.
No, absolutely.
We'll see if we can get that.
The question is, can we escape with our lives?
Nobody told me it's called the Death House. I never went in here.
just watch out for the broom closets.
Just don't. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. I thought this was. I didn't know this was Death House. I thought it was the Durst House.
It is the Durst House.
It is the Durst House.
I just hope Fred doesn't show up.
Fred Durst.
Oh man. Okay.
I made the comment last week about that.
Yeah.
I did.
There was a couple. There's a couple things popping in my head, but we'll leave it at that for now.
Mm-hmm. Isn't it?
Got the red baseball cap backwards.
Oh yeah.
With that, with the snacks being chewed in my ear, are we ready for a recap?
Chop. All right. Accelerate. Well, it is longer notes because it's a lot of introductions. I'll try to keep it as brief as I can.
First of all, did everybody unmute their Discord?
Exactly. I just triple checked. I did. Yes.
All right.
Speaking of muting, do you guys know how to mute? Like, if you hold down Control Shift M.
I don't know how to do it as a hotkey for
Discord. Yeah, that's the hotkey for Discord. Control and Shift and press M.
I have my hotkeys set up.
Yeah, yeah.
Discord. I have keybinds. So
I changed mine.
I set mine up. I just don't remember.
I also have buttons on my Stream Deck to do it. So
you can check your
hear you talking to the chat. That's why I was mentioning it.
Yeah.
Okay. So basically, each of our characters individually fell asleep and had a dream about an old man basically beckoning us to aid him in helping his noble prince, after which we have a dream about a red-haired woman running away from a dark presence in a castle and jumping to her own fate. We basically, after that, each wake up, and not in the place that we originally fell asleep, but we wake in the company of six others in a forest clearing filled with mist. Next to each of them is a doll that resembles them. Each of them reacts to the doll differently. Kirkle grabs his fishing rod and begins to walk into the fog. As he walks into it, he begins choking and coughing and returns to the group. Yeah, unfortunately got exhaustion from that. They're confused as to why they are there. As they're talking, the flames of the fire in front of them churn green, and a figure on a horse appears with glowing red eyes. The fire then explodes, and the fog moves, exposes the path to the west. Tot grabs his things and says, "I'm done standing around here," and the group gathers their things and begins to follow him. As they walk, the fog closes the path behind them. After a few hours of travel, the fog opens up and reveals a house. They see two children, one younger, holding a rag doll, and a girl that's a bit older, about 50 yards away. Hawk walks closer to ask the children where they are. The girl tells them that they are afraid because there's a monster in their house. Their mother and father went back into the house to get their nanny and baby sibling and haven't come out. They beg them to go in. They seem sincere to Tarnok, and he isn't afraid of any monsters, as he says. They walk through the front gate towards a dark brick house. Tarnok walks up and opens up the front gate and walks towards a heavy oak door. He knocks on the door. From inside, they hear the sound echo and no other sounds. They try the door, and it is not locked. Inside is a gorgeous foyer with old family paintings. There's a family crest of gold with a gold windmill on a red plaque that reads Durst. Kirkle jump or I jump Avalar, I'm blaming it on you. Kirkle jumps into the balcony on the third floor. Inside, he hears a baby's cry and a woman singing. As the fog is starting to close in on them, they all walk into the foyer. The door slams behind them. They see an ornate interior with a harpsichord and a crying child off in the distance. The sounds of a harpsichord and a crying child in the distance. Tarnok walks to the base of the stairs and yells out, but there is no answer. Tok notices the dining hall is set for a feast of eight, with intricate carvings on the wall that look more ominous up close than they had from the distance. He begins to make his way Sorry, Tarnok begins to make his way up, gesturing for Tok to follow. As they do, the music stops. They feel a blast of wind and see, as they see a painting with the two children that they had met earlier, with a man and a stern-faced woman, looks very unhappy, holding a swaddled baby. The rest of the group join them, and Balfour opens a thin door. Inside, he sees a dirty room with two lumpy beds and servants' clothing hanging in the closet. Tok opens the door next to it. It is a well-stocked library. He begins to search the desk of the room. He finds several things, including a family seal and a key. He looks over the books and notices one of them that doesn't seem quite right. He yells out, "I found something," and shows them the book. As he does this, Tok, or I'm sorry, was it Tarnok? The wrong person over.
Crom.
Who was it? Who was it who pulled on it?
Crom.
Crom.
Is it Crom? Okay. Crom reaches out and pulls the book. The book itself swings open and it, I'm sorry. The bookshelf swings open and is tightly filled with old tomes. There is a skeleton inside closed in a chest. Crom pulls the skeleton out of the chest and inside finds three blank black books, three spell scrolls, and a deed to the house, and a windmill, and a signed will where Gustav and Elizabeth Durst lead everything to Rose and Thornbolt Durst, the children they had seen out front. In the skeleton's hand is a note with a seal of a raven on it. Crom opens the letter and calls the intended, opens up the letter. It calls the intended recipient pathetic servant. It is from Strahd von Zorbich. Tarnok goes into the final room alone. Inside is a harpsichord and a large harp, but there is no one in the room. He moves to go up the stairs and the group follows. When they hit the top of the stairs, the crying stops, but they do now hear a woman's lullaby. The floor is dirty and unkept, in dire contrast to what they saw downstairs. Tarnok reaches for the door as the air armor animates and grabs his hair. Zephyr, with her bow ready, draws, shooting and hitting it. Tarnok picks up the suit of armor and throws it down the center of the circular stairs, and it clatters down to the bottom floor. The sound, hearing the sound, this concerns Kirkle, so he opens up the French doors leading into the balcony. Inside, he finds a creature holding a child, saying, "Walter, stop crying." He moves past them and towards the door of the landing, where he hears the commotion coming from. Kirkle walks back into the nursery, and the ghostly woman sits straight and stops singing. Crom opens the door next to him. Inside, it is dark, and he feels the prickles of an animated broom on his neck. He grabs it and tries to break it, eventually gives up on the fight. Zephyr runs down the stairs to meet the armor head-on, soon followed by Crom. The broom turns its attentions on Tok and knocks him out. Zephyr slashes several times at the animated armor as Valkyr finishes off. There you go. We have two dead enemies and a specter.
I am very impressed with the amount of note-taking you took.
and an unconscious dragonborn.
And with that, we'll go ahead and zoom on in to where we left off. This fight after this deadly broom knocked Tok out. So where we leave off, right after the combat round. Good, arms are down. We're at, guys. Jamie, I hope that helps. Each stream on Multi Twitch has a separate volume slider and mute button. Maybe that help you? I hope.
Yeah, when I clicked on the link that you put in, which I changed my link, so mine's accurate now. When I clicked on the link that you put in, all four of them were muted. So all four of them are turned off. So.
Gotcha, yeah. Yeah, usually I set mine that way because I get feedback.
Yeah. I usually click on the tab. I right click on the tab and just mute the site.
Gotcha. We're gonna fade out the Muzak. Hopefully it fade out. Nope, it didn't fade out. All right, so here we are.
Nope.
Crom rolls a one. Interesting.
Oh, he's getting it out of the way right off the bat, huh?
Mm. So remember, you are down. I didn't want to make this adjustment by looking at your character point. 13 here, but so you're technically 0 HP, but you're not in a death saving throw, unconscious.
Right. Oh, that's weird. It didn't update, did it?
No.
Because I am so I have mine set to 1 current, so that I'm not in the saving throws. But
oh, I got you. Okay.
That's weird that it didn't update. Yeah. I think it was because if I go to 0, it's going to force me to do death saves.
Fair. All right, we'll leave it that way then. But yeah, it was updating last week. It just 15.
Yeah.
Hope everything worked.
Well, I can stabilize him.
Yeah, I can as well. I mean, I can heal him up right now since I'm right here. Since I just destroyed, the enemy of Tok.
You go ahead. I only have 5 like health points I can use. So you go ahead.
Okay. Yeah. So. All right, just healed him for 9.
Okay.
All right. So as you guys are healing Tok for 9, Cargill.
Sure.
Is Kirkle, thank you. Is
I'm gonna say that
between,
name wrong.
Between you and Corgi, I'm gonna this entire campaign. But notice this lady now kind of relaxes and starts the lullaby again. And then you start hearing the baby cry. I believe you opened that door. I believe, right? So we did see was in there.
Yep.
Just reminder. It was a cradle.
I want to say it was a cradle that was empty. But no, I might be misremembering. Or, no, wait, she was empty. She had no baby in her hand, and the baby was now in the cradle. But the baby stopped crying.
Not necessarily.
Either way, it creeps me out. I walk the other way.
It's all good. So what you see...
Walking up with a group.
I got so many weapons. Windows open. So just apologize to anybody in my chat speaking or typing. I can't see it. So no, as you open that door, you do see a cradle draped in a black cloth over top of it. The baby is crying from that. But funny enough, you notice the woman is positioned like she's holding a baby, but you can't see because she's facing the wall. And she starts singing a lullaby again as the baby starts crying again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm going to walk over by the group. It. I mean, part of me wants to just jump out the window and leave, you know, but it didn't work out too good last time.
Alright, so we're back to the party with you.
As he comes back in and is, Tox getting up and everything like that, I kind of lean on my staff and look at him and go, so, how about that combat?
So what's gonna? I'm gonna rub my head. I have a very strong dislike for this place.
What's going on in there? I say at Kirkle.
Ribbit.
Yeah. Do I understand him?
Nope.
Nope. Your translator is Zephyr.
Zephyr. You're up here, right?
And I don't think she's informed us that she can understand them yet.
Yeah, it's like technically, and I don't think anybody knows they speak it yet.
So no. He's hanging out, but none of us actually know that anyone else can understand him.
Yep, I'm just a frog walking around with you, riveting. Merfolking.
I guess I'll ask Tarnok. Like, where's that singing coming from? Because I assume we can hear it out here in the hall.
Yes. And you're hearing a baby cry now.
I must be coming from in here, but this frog person can't tell us anything what's going on.
Kirkle.
I guess it's... Are you a Pokemon? Must be your own name. Alright, I'll come in.
And as you see You see the woman facing the wall, almost like she's cradling something in her hand. All you see is her back.
Like that? Does she look all purple and glowy like that? No?
Okay. No. I had to do that from the last time because I was going to play something depending on what you guys... Right. So, no, it's a fair woman. It looks... You can't see her face. Honestly, you can't really see any kind of skin either, but she is in a white dress. She does have a kind of a nursemaid's bonnet, if you want to call it. I think it's bonnet, on her head.
Help.
And she's singing a lullaby. Is he just hushed
a
little bit?
There's a woman in here. Miss, are you okay?
No answer.
I get paint.
All right. There's no an answer. She just continues to sing her lullaby.
All right. So I take a step towards her. Miss. Reaching out.
You're reaching out to her?
Yeah.
Okay. No answer.
Okay. So I'll touch her.
Your hand goes right through her.
Okay, now I take a step back.
baby's crying tremendously. Walter, calm down, stop. And she goes back into her lullaby. Hush, little baby. Don't say a word. All right,
so where's the baby?
Coming from the nursery, which is behind you. So behind you is a door. Opens up. All you got is probably, there's shades, so there's not even moonlight shining into that room. But you do see a cradle draped in a black cloth.
Okay. I won't want the torch. I'll go in here, I guess. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Baby's still crying. Louder now, since you're...
Somebody shut the door and lock it.
Let me know when the screaming stops.
So I reach out to the cradle.
You reach out to the cradle, okay.
There's a black thing on the cradle?
Yeah, it's like a black cloth.
Okay, so I'll grab the black cloth and lift it.
You're grabbing the cloth, okay.
Okay, yeah.
What are you doing with the cloth?
Lifting the cloth so I can see underneath it.
So you're lifting a piece of the cloth, and inside the cradle, or the crib, I should say, I keep saying cradle, but it's a crib.
Okay.
What you see is a tightly wrapped baby-sized bundle, head to toe. The baby's crying, and it's there. But the nurse stops singing, and with a
but she's still standing in the corner.
Still standing in the corner, and we're back to you. She speaks very softly at first, that her baby would bring life to that, and to the cult. He said he would leave her, and kick her out, and we could be together at last, and I would raise all the children on my own. But he lied. She starts crying and weeping.
Who lied? Who are you speaking of?
Answer. As you push your hands on it, it clicks. It pulls back and slides to the right, and you're exposed to a gust of rush of air, cold air, and you reveal a... Can I get into the... I think move this, put that over here, and it reveals a cobweb riddled filled wooden staircase leading up.
Yeah, there's the attic space above us. Crom saw him disappear into there. A little bit woozy, but I'm like, okay, and just follow.
Okay, I Can I lean out and ask Zephyr, can you check the rest of the floor? We're gonna go upstairs.
And I'm immediately gonna say, don't touch anything.
We'll try not to.
Alright, so Tarnok and Krom are gonna head up to the attic space. You come to basically to a door. Top of the stairs. And Zephyr and Cargo and Tok and...
So when I open these doors, I just realized that it's just the balcony?
Yeah, actually they were left open when Cargo came in during the combat round. But you look outside, it's an outside. You notice now that the mist is up against the house. Can't see past it, but the balcony's up.
Alright. I'll just kind of look at that and be like, okay, and then I'm going to head towards where Arnok and Krom, you know, walked into.
Okay, so you bring you up the stairs. Up in the wrong... There you go.
Well, I was moving it at the same time. I think that's why I did that.
Oh, gotcha.
We need a torch.
You didn't bring one with you.
I don't need a torch.
I don't need a torch.
As you guys figured that out. Talk. Where are you heading?
Well, I guess, I mean, we've investigated this room, I suppose, so I guess I'll follow.
Okay, Talk comes upstairs. Everybody's on the landing. Zephyril and Cargo.
Everybody's gonna come up. No, nobody's gonna help Zephyr. Okay.
Well, help her what? I mean, we already searched the rest of the floor.
No, we haven't.
We haven't? Oh, I thought we did. Oh, all right. Well, then I'll stay down there.
All right. After that conversation, Taco's stomping down.
Yep.
All right, let's go back to the guys in the attic. You guys notice a doorway as you come up to the steps. There is a doorway there.
I listen to the door. Anything, any noise from inside that's not the singing from the lady down below?
The door listens back.
Give me a perception.
Mimic.
The door says, "Hi, Tarnok. Long time to see. How you been?"
That's not great. It's not the best.
That's not the worst either, but you do not hear anything.
I do not hear anything.
Why you stop, big devil man?
Do we have a rogue in this crew?
Nope.
Okay. Then I just open the door and look inside.
Agree.
Krom doesn't like tight spaces.
Empty hallway.
Yeah, so as you pull through this is a bare hallway. It's choked with dust and cobwebs. You notice on the north side, the door that is padlocked. From your side.
This one here? Or this one here? Or that one there?
And there's obviously a door here, here.
Is there any noise on the other side of the padlock door?
What's this right here? Does the wall just ends there? Is that a window?
Can I perceive anything from the padlock door?
It's probably more of a window there.
Okay.
You, Greg, give me perception?
Who?
So you put your ear up against there. You hear nothing. It's just silence.
Okay. If there's silence, I'm going to try to break the lock off.
Okay. Let's go back down. Let's go. Before you go do that, let's go down to the second floor. Third floor for that group
down
there.
Third floor.
Oops, I'm just getting the wrong paint.
I guess I'll go join Urkel over at the
And I'll follow you out. I just realized that the library was on the floor below us, right?
Mm-hmm.
That was the, yeah, I mistook this for the library over here up in the top.
Okay.
What do we see in this hallway?
So is, you got a double door to the right, pretty ornate built, like it's almost like a, well, it's something rich there, and this is just basically a single door outside.
Yeah, I'm just gonna open up the double door.
Okay. It creaks open. Moose.
And I step to the side and let them walk through.
Let me get to the text. I got. As you squint at a pair of double doors, as you open it, so as the hinges squeal as you touch and reveal a magnificent suite choked with dust, collect rotten tiger skin lies beneath the ashen fireplace. Watched over by a whittling portrait of the Durst parents. Four poster bed curtains hang open, revealing yellow sheets, while the wind rattles a door leading out towards the balcony, which is outside. Right here, sorry. They got a door. It has a little extra flavor here. It says, where are the servants? You can't but wonder. Demand even. Where are the Durst? How might the first two floors be so immaculate, but while the third, that's rotten and travesty?
Who asked that?
It's a flavor text that asks a question.
Flavor text.
Oh
yeah. When we came to the third floor last week, he said that it was much different from the two floors below it. That this one looked very unkempt and.
Right. I just got confused.
All right. I'll kind of like peek my head into the room and see what I see. I guess. I'm not gonna walk in. Just peer in. See if they see anything suspicious or.
Okay, so you see what I basically described, but kind of closer inspection. The wardrobe, these dressers here, if you will, are empty, completely empty. Everything is gone. Not even a single hanger remains. Now, Elizabeth's vanity is caked in grime and dust. A greasy jewelry box sits on the desk. I guess it's here. Regardless of what the map that's showing you. So a greasy old jewelry box sits on the desk. There is a dumbwaiter. You know, it's half open. I believe it's here. That out of the way.
You're clicking on the wrong layer because I don't see you ping it. There you go.
Oh, yeah. Sorry.
Yeah, no, I had to move the dynamic lighting bar. But the wardrobe's here. I'm going to assume this is the desk over here.
Mm-hmm.
And I said there's a dumbwaiter there, and gate almost stuck in its frame. You find a dusty mirror set upon a closet door, and beyond shoes, disgusted expression you see in the reflection, only gloomy neglect of the suit. You're not really looking at the mirror for that.
Well, guys upstairs. I guess I'll walk slowly in.
Okay.
So.
And you're in. Creepy. You're right. The question to be asked is, everything was so immaculate downstairs. Almost a dinner was prepped. I'm up here in this complete disarray. Brom, you want to hit that lock?
Smack that lock.
Okay.
What do
go
I
ahead.
The strength
roll. Yeah, do a strength with add your bonus there.
Bonus proficiency of 2?
Yep. So you hit the lock. You hit the lock with your axe, and it's just ding, but it doesn't break.
I want to try again.
Okay. And you swing out again and goes ding.
Ding. I can't ding. Break it.
So it seems.
I'm starting to get a complex here. How can he be a 7.5-foot Goliath if he can't break a simple lock?
We've all been asking that question.
That brings it to the crew in the attic. What's next? And you watch Krom try to crack this padlock.
All right, I'm gonna go to this door and check this door over here.
The north or the south side?
Oh, there's two doors right there?
Yes.
The north side.
As you open the door, you gaze upon a spare bedroom smothered by cobwebs. Spiders crawl from the wardrobe and rows to greet you, new visitor.
Little regular spiders?
Mm-hmm. Yep. You see a nightstand, a slender bed, a rocking chair, an empty wardrobe that has spiders just came out and they're racing out the door like, you know, just shooting light on them type thing. All iron.
Okay. I say yuck, and I immediately try to open the door to the south.
Okay. I'll go back down to the guys on the third floor real quick as they're searching that one. You guys are searching the master bedroom. You see nothing really of interest here, per se. I'm
going to ask Zephyr what we're looking for. Just because I'm out of the loop.
I just look at him and I walk in the room. Except I take the torch with me. Dang it!
Nice.
Anticlimactic.
So there's nothing in the desk? Or everything seems to be cleared out?
So you see a jewelry box sitting on the...
I'll investigate it.
Jewels.
Okay, I'm gonna go over here and look around this corner.
Okay.
Dragons just, love jewels.
Jump on the bed.
You can jump on the bed if you want.
I mean, I might as well.
Okay. Purgle goes over there and starts jumping on the bed.
I roll my eyes a little bit.
Dust is flying everywhere.
It appears to be an old, I don't know why I said it greasy, but it's been deteriorating for a while. There's nothing glamorous about the jewelry box within itself. You see no deception for a trap or anything. It's just like the wife of the house. Jewelry's.
Is it open or no?
Not open.
Okay. I guess I'll open it with my axe. Like I'll just like from arm's length. I'll just
okay.
Try to flip. Talk
backs up. Talk backs up with his axe and just goes creak, opens it up.
I've already had my ass kicked by a broom in this house. So yeah.
And the jewelry box a mimic. Here, no, I'm just kidding. Yeah, it looks like it's you see silver and gold inside. It's pretty safe, so you open it up. It's, I'm sorry, I do apologize. The jewelry box is made of silver with gold plating on it. So that by itself is worth 75 gold pieces for the jewelry box. But inside it contains 3 gold rings, 25 gold pieces each, and a thin platinum necklace with a topaz pendant worth 750 for side notes. You gotta find a place to sell them.
To platinum and topaz, right?
Yep. Yeah, so okay. Platinum necklace, thin, and a topaz pendant. And again, the jewelry box is worth 75.
Okay. I'll pick it up and put it in my pack.
Okay.
I'm gonna give him a stinky look.
All right. So Zephyr kind of eyes you. As you stuff it in your pack, and Quirkle's just jumping on the bed and joining and have a good old time. And let's go back to the attic. So you guys just came out of this spider encrusted room there. Prom says yuck.
Yuck.
Tim, you're going to open this the next
yep.
behind you.
South door.
Yeah, south door.
All right, so as you creep that door open...
It's a room full of ghosts.
Who are you going to call?
His chamber is packed with old furniture draped in yellow sheets. Chairs, coat racks, coaches dabble with mold. Coaches. Standing mirrors, mannequins that loom out from the shadows like forgotten windows, witnesses to a ruined past time. There's a wooden trunk that sits nearby. It's slightly covered ajar.
Okay, I go to the trunk. Where's the trunk?
I was trying to find it on the map.
Well, let's just pretend it's this thingy right here.
Fair.
Well, unless it's in the back of the room and you have to walk past all these ghosts to get there.
Work with two different techs here. Let me get a better...
As Zephyr's giving me the cockeyed look, I'm just going to look at her and go, what, no one here needs it?
And
okay.
If any of that carpet lion, that carpet tiger attacks you.
So what I should have said, I'm working with two different types of text here. But what I should have said is this right here is the shape of a chest, but it's covered in a bed sheet stained with blood, dry blood.
Uh oh.
And that's right here, you guys.
Right next to that stone.
I did the stone.
Okay. I tried to open it. Off the bloody sheet.
Alright, you pull off the bloody sheet and you do see a chest.
Is it has a lock? Can I open it?
It doesn't look like you have a lock.
Open
got
it.
A padlock. Want to try and break it?
You do open it and what you see is a skeleton remain of a woman dressed soaked in blood from the front, especially around her stomach region.
I think I found. I look at Tarnok and I think I found the ghost lady's body.
Did you find the baby?
I found the ghost lady's body. Let's destroy it and kill the ghost.
I think that's what. I don't think that'll take care of our problem. We should definitely ask the others.
With that, I'll zoom back down to the third floor as you guys are finishing wrapping up the master suite, essentially. Argo's still jumping on the bed.
Could you do me a favor and give me whatever vision I need to not hold the torch, and I'll just say I'm holding the torch?
Yeah, fair.
Me too.
But then
we
don't have the fun of people having to fight over the torch.
Yeah,
right? Someone pulling
it's all about
torch.
This group is all about this. That's how this group started, fighting over a torch.
Okay,
that's
we can still fight over the torch.
And then, everyone, when you get a chance, can you look at my character because my dark vision does not seem to be working.
Okay.
Like I can see when everybody else is like what they can see, but if I like where I'm standing now, I can't see where we came from. It's all black, and I should be able to see that.
Yeah, it got shut off.
Same as mine. The fog of war is permanent. And I can see what everybody else sees.
Okay, I can see it now. Thanks.
How about you, Cargo? I took the torch away. You should be able to see now.
I can see what Balfour sees. And
only
yes, and I'm good. I can see my own line of sight.
All right. You guys wrapping up there, Master Suite?
Mm-hmm. I want to check the fireplaces. I noticed, jumping on the bed, there's a fireplace in this room, and there's a fireplace in the other room. And, you know, IRL, I'm from the south, I don't know if that's normal, but to me, it seems out of place. So I want to check the fireplaces.
Alright, just ash, like a fire once burnt, that kept the building warm since there's no central heating, so each place did have become a fireplace. And there is still ash in here, but nothing of interest. Catching your eye.
Okay.
I was thinking about that earlier, too. It's like, you don't have fireplaces. You have it on the ground floor. You don't have it on, you know, the other floors. You usually don't have a fireplace there.
No.
I imagine it would be like a central
northeast,
stacker kind of thing.
In the northeast, the old houses all had fireplaces in every room.
Yeah. Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah.
Usually, yeah. Usually you have
two large chimneys on each end of the house.
Okay.
And then the fireplaces were all flued into those chimneys, and there was one in every room, and there's usually a large one downstairs for cooking.
Okay.
All right. You guys wrap it up in the room here.
I mean,
yeah, I'll peek out this door, I guess. Okay.
It's the balcony door, stained glass with curtains. You pull the curtains back. You can see outside. It's a balcony, mist surrounding the outside of the house, but it is. It looks like from your direction, from your perspective of being in the house, that's. Where I say that. Nope, that's back. The backyard.
Okay, I guess I'll move to.
And then what's this, Avalar? Over in this corner.
Oh. I assumed it was a window, I guess.
Question.
I just marked myself as dead. Yeah, it definitely looks like it's something, but it's too small. Unless that's the dumbwaiter. And this was a closet.
I thought the dumbwaiter was over here.
Oh, that's probably the dumbwaiter upstairs.
I think that's what I'm thinking.
Yeah.
I'm looking. That is a dumbwaiter. Yeah, I pointed to the wrong one. This is the closet.
This is probably here, also the dumbwaiter.
What's a dumbwaiter?
It's a thing that brings
it's like a little elevator.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Food up and down the stairs.
They can serve food downstairs. You could press it, and then you do it, and yeah, pull the little thing, and it would actually take it all the way up and stuff.
Yep.
And you'd hear stories back then of where, like, kids would use it for hide and seek or play games, and they go up and down, and then sometimes they get stuck.
Actually, fully, the dumbwaiter doesn't go to the attic. This is a window looking out over the balcony that Corgi was looking out. On a roof.
Okay.
Strange enough as that appears to be.
So I could fit in this thing and ride it down to the basement, is what you're saying.
Yes, you can.
Yeah, you could.
I just want to open the door next to me, though.
Alright, so this door right here?
Yeah. I don't know why I couldn't open it.
I have a bar here. Dynamic left.
Gotcha.
As you open that up, it looks just like a dark bathroom containing a wooden tub called Beet, a small iron stove with a kettle resting on top, and a barrel under a spigot in the cistern on the roof used to collect the rain. Freeze it down to the pipe through the spigot. But however, by just pure inspection, the plumbing no longer works. Basically, that is about it with the floor just now, if you guys...
So, I'm going to reach out to open the closet, and then I'm going to think back to the last closet we went into, and I'm just going to put my hand back down by my side and walk out of the room.
Okay.
Good thinking, buddy.
Once bitten, twice shy.
Great.
Okay.
You guys can basically make your way upstairs.
Okay. And I'm going to move in this corner because I want to check out this door. You said there's a lock at this door down here?
No. Only locks.
No, the lock is...
Okay.
The lock is here.
So let's go back to Krom's. Did tell you about this bones in this chest, so let's leave off with that. As the guys are coming upstairs, Balfour's moving to the south. Well, actually, technically, it's west. To look at that door, he's talking to Katarnak about the woman in the chest. Skeleton in the chest.
As they come up, I go, we found her body in here. Point into this room here, talking to Tak.
Whose body?
Seems the woman's, I guess. I walk in. I want to start looking under the stuff as I walk through the room, looking under the sheets.
Okay. Just, old furniture, statues.
Nothing exactly. That's gonna attack us, or nothing that looks like gonna attack us, and nothing that's gonna that's worth money that I can just pick up and take.
Everything there looks pretty heavy to carry out. Okay. It's basically marble statues, furniture.
I can't carry marble statues. What's up?
You can certainly try. They're mannequins too. Like there was a dress fitting room and things of that nature. You get basically it's an idea. It's basically a storage room.
Yeah.
I walk over to Balfour and I whisper quietly to him, these idiots are going to get us killed.
So as he reaches for the door to open up, I assume that's what you wanted to do, Balfour?
I'm first going to listen to see if I can hear anything on the other side of the door.
Go ahead and roll perception as the other two characters are talking about the woman in the box. And Tor and I are sitting outside.
How's that? A 24.
As you listen through...
I think your mic's cutting out.
You
sure.
Yep.
Yeah, we didn't hear most of that.
You basically hear a creaking like of a rocking chair.
Okay, I pull my head a bit away from the door and I look back at Zephyr and kind of whisper, there's something moving in there. Then I look over and I see Tak and I start waving to Tak, come on over. Hey, Tak, come here. Come here, buddy.
What?
There's something moving in here. You want to go check it out?
Not really. What do you hear moving? I guess I'll listen to the door.
It's like a creaking. I can't tell if it's like maybe if it's a chair going back and forth. Something's creaking and moving in there. Hey, let's get Krom to come in here.
Yeah, get Krom to do it.
Krom will do it.
Krom will eat anything.
Hey, go get Krom.
Krom can't hear you through the wall. Him and Tarnak still talking about the woman in the box.
Is the door locked?
I haven't checked yet. I just listened.
Speaking about locked doors, the one that I'm next to, is that a padlock or is it just locked?
It's a padlock.
Okay.
Hey Krom, there's something moving in here. You wanna go check it out?
It might be food. I listen to the door. Can I perceive anything?
You hear rocking.
Rocking?
It's like creaking of a rocking chair.
I open the door.
Before he does, I am stepping away.
Yeah.
With that, let's take a quick 5 minutes.
Really? Why is everybody abandoning me?
Yeah. Let's take a quick 5 minute, and I like Dom's, I probably got it late, but the dad joke. Only haunted houses have dumb waiters.
That's it.
Quick 5 minute, guys. I do, gotta run to the fast room.
Okey-dokey.
Watch out for cobwebs.
Yes.
I'm gonna make a cup of coffee.
Maybe one, please.
Discuss amongst yourselves. Oh, you're gonna get it for me? Okay, yeah. Cool. Thanks, bud.
I want to stay down here till the movie ends.
Okay, cool.
I have my
waiter.
I leave in 36 minutes and 49 seconds.
Okay, buddy. Thanks. How you feeling, Bully? If you're still there.
I'm doing fine. I'm painting.
Cool. What you painting tonight?
I'm finishing up Nils' model.
Okay, cool.
Oh, shit. I shouldn't have black edged this yet. I needed to do... I still have a dry brush left to take care of. I'm waiting for this wash to dry. I was like, oh, I can black edge it now. Shit. No, I can't. But I am, anyway.
I got the yawns.
Not the yawns.
I didn't realize how hard it would be to not be able to communicate. I mean, I can follow around, right? Metagaming it, but as a character, this would just be so confusing.
You should become a minion and jump on someone's shoulder.
I mean, well, I will, but
I think what you should do is I should tie you to my back, and then you could be backpack Yoda frog. And if anything sneaks up behind me, you'll never get advantage.
Nice.
I gotta
look and see. There's like two people I can't talk to. So basically, I can talk.
So we're just hanging out here. Is there? What do we think we should do with this body?
I mean, it's not like we're going outside to bury it.
I mean, for Tok's point of view, leave it and let's get the hell out of here.
That's it. We're just gonna leave.
That's. Oh, thank you, sir.
Okay, I can't talk to Tok.
I've seen enough.
we can assume that we have time to talk about this a minute.
I could talk to Tarnok.
I would believe so. You can talk to me. So when I talk to you, I talked to Con.
All right. So what is it? You speak primordial. You said, right?
Yep. So far I can't talk to Tok or Saga. Who's Saga?
Saga is that Vid's character?
Oh yeah, that's probably if you're looking at who's in the campaign, we have Foxy and Foxy's in Lost Mines, I think. And then Vidigarvia has a character in this campaign, but they're not playing.
Okay. And Krom, I can't talk to.
Why not?
He doesn't have. He's not able to speak to you.
Balfour. So literally, it's Tarnok and Zephyr. So as long as we stay together as a group.
What if I thought you could speak giant.
I gotta speak infernal, and you have to speak primordial.
It's fine. It's just like an accent. Okay,
so here,
right?
So,
no,
so,
but I mean, you have to say that you're speaking primordial and not.
I could only speak primordial.
Well, if you speak primordial, I should be able to understand a little bit of what you're saying.
I think the ruling was that the language comes from it. It's like the difference between Latin and Spanish or something, or that if it's written, maybe I can read like giant script or whatever, but not understand. I don't know. It gets.
I think we should sort of roll for it each time when you're trying to talk to me. I might catch a little bit what you're saying, or not really at all.
Yeah, I mean it's all fixed as soon as I get to like level 3.
Yep.
I'll be able to talk to everybody just fine, but
is that when you grow up and you're large enough to be a food item?
No, I get a familiar at that point.
Oh,
and I could just speak through the familiar.
Right now, you're looking like one of those monkey lizards from Star Wars.
In your eyes,
like you, in a way, you kind of look like dinner to me.
Oh. Who are you?
A giant.
Well, you're Krom?
Climb on your shoulders 5 seconds ago.
Yeah, I was like, I'm gonna take this delicious food stuff with me. Emergency food supply.
But seriously, I'm like 2 foot. When I was on the balcony,
I'm 7.5 feet. You're like
so terrified something would like swoop down and just snatch me up.
Yeah, like a sparrow.
Meanwhile, I can break a broomstick.
Boom. Boom.
Hey, the broomstick never hurt me. I was just dusting with it.
As far as this house, I'm lost. I've never been in such a riddly weird kind of campaign. I don't know what to do. It's like I feel like I'm playing Clue or something, and everybody's cheating.
Well, it is basically
pretty much
Clue.
Yeah, I think this is way different than I think most campaigns.
This is not, well, like Avalar keeps saying that this isn't a combat heavy campaign. This is more of a mind game.
And right? I was prepared for role play, and I was prepared mm-hmm. for combat, and like a puzzle room. This is like the whole thing is a puzzle. I'm so confused.
Well, you're all right. So you're literally in the first dungeon of the entire campaign. So you're getting a lot of background information. We're doing a lot of room searches. You're learning a lot of things that may or may not become relevant in weeks to come.
The only thing I see that's prominent is this. It's like a windmill or a mill on a hill.
Yeah.
And mm-hmm. in one area, it's like a nice golden windmill. And in the next, it's like on a bloody hill or something. Mm-hmm. Or maybe I'm reading that wrong, but I feel like that's symbolic of something.
The windmill carries throughout the whole house, right? It was on the plaque by the front door, which appears to be like the family crest,
mm-hmm.
I guess you would say, right? It was on, I think there was a shield with a windmill on it.
On a hill of red.
Yeah, it seems like really symbolic and.
But you'll also notice that everything throughout the house, all the ornate carvings of animals and everything else like that, aren't really animals, right? Or they are, or the ornate carvings are actually of animals. Until we get to the third floor,
yeah, it shows like ornate
carvings around the ornate carvings around the mirror are eyes that seem to follow you around the room as you walk.
Which I don't understand.
I'm back.
You gotta do something with this body. I'm sure there's something that we can do to help her.
I mean, I don't got any holy water.
Not that, man. No, that's not what I mean. There's gotta be something else that has to do with it.
Oh.
Do we search the body? We didn't search the body.
Don't touch anything.
I specifically said that.
Didn't he say it was a skeleton?
Yeah,
that was
but crammed
in that chest?
It was the skeletal remains in a bloody dress.
Yeah.
I was going to try the door.
Back. He's listening to our table talk.
No, this is good table talk.
Well,
I expect a little bit of this. This could be in character. You guys are just, you know,
I'm trying to open a door.
The Crom is about to open a door. Tarnak's going back.
Everybody else ran away.
So let's go ahead and do the...
Well, I mean, that's no different than what you did earlier when you ran away and closed the door.
He closed the door.
I specifically wanted nothing to do with what was in that room.
You tell him. I try to be, like, brave and, you know, like, ghost lady needs to, you know, go away and
man,
I try to burn.
Shot her, ran, and shut the door. You locked them
well,
in.
I was like, well, the thing is, she looked at me. She looked at me with those red eyes, and I was like, oh, like, I think my pants got heavier. And I pretty much ran out the door because I was like, I think she's angry at me.
Your door just opened, Crom.
Yeah,
it's kind of like, you know, like, ever seen the Indiana Jones? You know, when all the ghosts are coming out of the box, and they're all beautiful. But then all of a sudden they turn horrible.
Oh, like the.
I mean, that's the kind of thing I'm talking about, like face melting horror.
Yeah, the
arc. That's pretty much what I felt, and I ran out.
So the door squeals open as you open, describing your past horrific. Past horrific.
Am I allowed to go in here now? Sweet.
Yep, it's open. So, yeah, the ward.
Well, I don't think Avalar's. Well, Avalar's must be back if he took that border, that boundary down. But
he's back at his stream. But he's not unmuted.
Well, maybe
here.
He doesn't realize he's muted.
I was muted.
The whole
I was talking, and I was muted. But the stream heard me, I think.
Club, buddy, we all have done it.
I take a step in.
All right, you take a step in.
And he has torch.
Oh, he can't see anything. Pitch black.
That'll, second floor.
And he's here in the rocking chair right in front of him.
I hear a chair. Pass me a torch, please.
Dog.
Ooh.
Door squeals open into a spare bedroom choked with dust. Wardrobe lies open, but empty.
Is rocking chair moving on its own?
The desk is stained red wine, perhaps? The rocking chair rocks slightly as Raph comes from the window.
Ah, the window. I'm going to walk over to this desk, and I'm going, or right here, and I'm going to inspect the desk.
You look at the desk, but you can't help not notice there is a doll, lacy, in a lacy yellow dress, smiling at you. Webs drape her head like a wedding veil.
I see the doll, and I go to pick it up.
And you pick it up. Doll webs crumble off of it.
Kirkle shakes his head.
Give me a perception.
Is the doll alive?
Give me a perception, since you wanted to check the desk, too.
Okay. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. Perception.
Well, he's doing all that. I'm going to walk to the door just so I can kind of peer in.
Okay.
Super perception.
Nice. No, everything looks pretty standard order. This is an ordinary doll. It's dusty. It looks like a kid's plaything. Desk has nothing of value.
Okay, and then from there, I go to the window door. Is it a window door, or is it a sliding door?
It's a window.
It's a window. Okay, can I go through it or not?
Well, yeah, if you break the window out.
I mean, am I gonna jump out the window?
Yeah,
or is there a balcony there?
No, there's no balcony. So you're on the attic floor. You're looking out. Basically, you can see through it. It's a the mist is actually up against the house, but you can tell you're going to land right in front.
Okay, I'm going to go ahead and leave this room. Okay. And I say, look what I found. And I'm going to show the doll to Fungalore. Where is Fungalore?
There he is. Balfour.
I'll just call him Fungalore.
It's a doll.
Mm-hmm.
That's all that I found in this room.
I want to look in the chest with the body.
All right, go ahead. Just for give me a medicine check for giggles.
I'm gonna try to not touch things. I was told to not touch things.
Okay.
Hey, that's good.
Nice.
Cool.
Crit too.
Bitchin'.
Yeah, so from what you could tell, this was a horrific death. It does resemble the lady spirit that you saw downstairs, but because of the dress wounds and stuff, it was really attacking the womb area. So it was almost like a passion crime.
Okay. Is there anything else in the chest with her?
Her body.
Crom, even though we have nine intelligence.
No baby blanket?
Without disturbing too much? No. Can't see much. Just the body. But the way she's laying in there, she's not cuddling anything.
Crom has already figured out the entire mystery.
She did not go in there of her own free will.
It sounds like this is, as he said, it was a crime of passion. There can only be one special lady in a man's life. And it looks like this lady didn't win.
That's pretty good for a guy who's in the hallway.
Yeah, that's Tarnok's knowledge. Even though he did first open it up, he did first open up and he saw there was stab wounds all over the stomach region. That's probably a fault of the DM. I'm just trying to be gentle.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I...
Sum it up, she was carrying a baby and somebody attacked it.
Yep. Okay. Tak is standing in front of that door there.
Yeah, I guess I'm gonna try and bust the padlock off of it.
Okay.
With what do you want? Strength? Or
attack.
You want an attack roll?
Yep. Well, attack,
if frostbite on the padlock, would that give him maybe advantage or something for trying to make it a bit more brittle?
Sure.
Alright, so I'm gonna do...
Yeah, because I was thinking hit it with the butt end of my battle axe handle. Like, just try to come...
Yeah, so I'll frostbite it, so I'll, like, freeze the padlock itself.
Hey, Zephyr. Roll me... Yeah. As I get ready to swing this axe at this padlock, give me a wisdom check.
Am I right in the middle of all this? Duck it out.
Belfer, go ahead and... check go ahead
or
and...
save?
It would be a check. Or save. Okay. Check. Save? Ability check, essentially. I call it ability checks. Okay. Balfour, go ahead and cast your frost spell.
So what do you call ability checks?
It was just a check.
Yeah, it's a check.
Okay.
That wasn't a save.
So a straight wisdom check would be clicking on the up on the top of the page at wisdom. The wisdom saves would be added if you have proficiency or anything else added to it in the save throw. Like,
okay, so so Belfair casts his frost. The lock just freezes. The door freezes as well.
Okay, and I'm just gonna come down on it with the handle of my axe, like straight down on it.
Okay. Ding! Doesn't break it. Ice shatters off the door, and the ice and the lockpick and ice crumbles. Damage. Zephyr does.
Go ahead. No. Go ahead.
Something dawns on Zephyr about a certain key found in a certain desk.
Yeah, that is exactly what I was literally about to say. I was just about to say. I totally forgot
about that.
I figured. I gave
totally
it a break.
Out of that room.
I gave it a break.
I didn't think it went to a padlock because I'm.
I have it written right here on the sheet in front of me too. I totally forgot. I have it. It's circled right here. Iron key.
It was a week ago. I was just about to say that.
Yeah.
I threw a bone out because it was a week ago. So I figured.
It's funny because I looked right at it. It's circled right here in the center of my page. Is iron key. All right, so I'm gonna drop my axe and rub my head and go, wait a minute. And I'm gonna reach in my pouch and pull out this iron key.
Nice.
And try it in the lock.
If Zephyr tells you about it.
Why does Zephyr need to tell you about it?
I will say something. It just really dawned snotty. On me. I was gonna say, I could say something really snotty, like, didn't we have a key?
Nice.
So as Tok just realized after Zephyr's telling him about the key, he's padded. Oh man, the key. Puts it in the lock. Click. Padlock opens.
So I guess I'll raise my axe with my one hand and just kind of push the door open.
Hey, Tok, can I have a padlock and key?
So,
that's what I was going to do.
Real quick, as you were unlocking and undoing the padlock and the hinge that was holding it, you do hear familiar voices of two children that you heard outside the house singing rock, paper, scissors, shoot as you open the door. Empty.
When I hear shoot, I duck.
Empty as in there's no presence in this room. So as the padlock clings noisily as you work on a lock, then clatters to the ground. Everything quiets down. The gloom strangles this place. You spot two children-sized beds. Let me move the dynamic lighting bar. Actually see what I'm describing. Pink. All right. You spot two children-sized beds, a toy chest, and a dollhouse on top of that. It's perfect. It's a direct replica of the house you were in, the Derp Manor. What's most unsettling is that the room's sole window is bricked up, which is about this part of the house. Completely bricked up. That is until you spot two small children, skeletons dressed in tattered but familiar clothing from the children you saw outside, lay in the center of the room. Smaller of the two is cradled on the doll, as if alone couldn't change the future.
Doll look like the dolls that we had from earlier.
No.
The doll looked like it could change the future?
Yeah. Yep. This is more like the one I showed you in the picture. purple and a button eyes and here. But
right.
Your dolls look like you.
It's that one? Right. Well, yeah, but I meant like it's the same type of craft of doll.
Correct. Yeah, same
guys,
thing
with I'll be gone for like 1 minute, okay?
Yep. With that, Tarna, go ahead and give me a wisdom check.
Wisdoms. Is he wise in the ways of science?
Nope.
Okay, great. That's still good enough. You do realize the same quality of craftsmanship went into that doll you just found in the center of this floor, or as you open the door. It's the same one that Crom showed you. It's the same craftsmanship. It's also the same craftsmanship as the dolls you have. Represent you.
Oh. Someone said craftsmanship. I need to go in and investigate. Can I go in this room or not?
God said craftsmanship.
I go into the room, and I pull out the doll.
Okay.
You pulled this doll out of your pocket.
Okay. I feel that the doll probably belonged to them, so I leave the doll with them.
Okay, so you put the doll on a pile of bones there.
And, or do I put it in the dollhouse?
Yeah. Alright guys, Balfour is back.
Did anything happen when I did it?
Are you telling me or are you asking me?
Right? I'm asking you, I put it first on the
so you put it on the bones, nothing happened. What are you doing next?
I'm putting it in the dollhouse.
Okay, as soon as you touch the dollhouse, a sudden chill seizes your spine. Two children... here. Zach. Transparent, but is Zach leave those children you saw?
I say we meet again.
She's creating the older one, the girl is creating her little brother as Rouse, as she's Rose, her name, scowls and asks, "Are you here to play with us?"
What do you mean by play? What kind of games you have in mind?
Well, we could play dolls. We could play. I don't know. It's been so long since we had company. We've been locked in here forever.
Forever. Don't you want to be free?
I so much want to be free.
How do we free you?
But we can't be free. Parents won't let us. Monster in the basement.
In the basement. If we take care of this monster in the basement, will you be free?
I don't know what you mean by free.
Door's leave the open. House.
Can't leave the house.
Uh-oh. You mind if I come back? I need to talk to my friends.
You brought friends?
Lots of friends.
Please don't leave us. Please don't leave us.
And I leave. I'm sorry, little ones. I had to go.
Who are you speaking to?
the two children we saw outside. Yeah, they're transparent, and they're inside the room playing dolls.
There's a monster
in the basement.
And it seems that they say that they cannot leave the house at all. And that mother and father won't let them because there's a monster in the basement. So, let's go. I suggest that we go to the basement. For it must be the thing that's keeping everything, all the ghosts around here. Anybody?
I assumed it was said in comments, so I'm just staying quiet.
Okay. Well, I'm going to start heading to the basement. So that's where.
Don't leave! Don't leave! They scream from the.
I don't like this. I don't like this place. I like it less by the minute.
Do we see them? The kids?
Yes. Yeah. Hell yeah.
Okay. What if we get rid of the monster?
Yes, please get rid of the monster. He's in the basement.
Okay, so we have to leave to go down to the basement. Okay? I have high persuasion.
Can I be persuasive? I'm so scared. give me a persuasion check.
Less than expected.
But I'm so scared. We've been locked in here.
It's starving. It'll be okay. Let us go get rid of the monster first. And then we can come back. And Krom will play with you.
Last time someone locked us in here like this, we died from hunger.
We won't lock the door. We'll leave the door open.
I'm going to go over to Balfair. And I'm going to say, not quietly, but I guess I'll say this to everybody who's around. They say they can't leave. Who invited us in?
Good point.
Oh, in the very beginning, they said that the monster took away their parents and dragged their parents into the house.
Right. But if they can't leave this room, who was that outside?
No, that was them outside.
But they can't leave this room.
They're ghosts. They can go anywhere they want.
They just said they can't leave.
But they also could lie, probably. So, I mean, there's that.
But we don't lie. We're not lying. We can't leave this room.
So, did you speak to us? Did you speak to us at the gate?
No, it wasn't us.
Was it the monster?
I dislike this place more and more by the minute.
It wasn't the monster in the basement.
Can I divine sense good and evil?
I'm going. Sure.
You can try.
All right. It's anything within 60 feet.
Okay.
Whether or not they're good or evil, a fiend or undead.
Is this a once a day spell?
It is 5 times per long rest.
I'll throw you a bone. You haven't had a long rest yet. No, they are lawfully good.
They're lawfully good. Okay. Well, then, I get a second one.
They're innocent little children. Leave them alone.
I only used it one time. All I did was just decide whether or not they're good. I think they're telling the truth.
If anybody looks evil, it's you with horns.
Oh, man.
But.
Wow.
Don't
that is yet
us.
To be seen.
Don't leave us.
Well, you can leave the room, right? You just can't leave the house.
Can't leave our room. Not while the bodies are still. Does he point to the sky?
It wasn't them outside. While their bodies are still here. Okay. So
oh, that's something I can ask him. So, what is your relationship to your bodies?
What?
When I say that, I mean like, do you need to be buried to rest in peace, or is there a reason why you're tied to this room?
Yes, we need to be buried to be rest. Move on. The bodies act like a anchor in this world.
So okay.
We have to bury them out back.
I will say is that I'm going to help you find rest. And then from there, I'm going to gather up the sheet off the bed. And I'm going to take all the bones and put them in the sheet. And then pretty much like a big picnic basket kind of sheet. And then I'm just going to...
Father always told us of a family's crypt basement.
Oh, there's a crypt in the basement, so we have to get the other body, too.
Yep, I'm going to go over there and grab that body, too, in the chest, put all its bones, too, with the... and pretty much just collect them.
Thorn walks up to Tarnok. Do you know how to get to the basement?
No.
Hey guys, I'll be back in a second. All my stuff closed out on me.
Alright, no problem. No problem.
Just letting you know.
Yep.
Do we know how to get to the basement?
I assume it's down.
Yeah, but I didn't remember seeing any stairs.
Can they come with us?
No. Is the entrance outside?
Not yet.
That's the...
Since the anchor is their bones, can they follow us or lead us?
Did you answer me?
One at a time. So, Brom, no, we can't leave the room, but the bones keep us in this mortal world. We have to be laid to rest. But we can't leave the room. That's where we died at.
Is the entrance to the basement outside?
No. As she points, as Rose points to the dollhouse. There's a secret door in the attic. Points. If I move away this bar, the storage area where you found the chest full of bones from the nursemaid. You notice from the dollhouse perspective, there is a secret door there that goes all the way from the attic, all the way through to the basement. 10 feet below certain levels.
So, are we in the attic now?
In the attic,
yes.
Oh, okay.
So,
is the secret door right here?
Nah, it's actually right here.
It's over here in the corner of the storage room.
Let me do this.
You can sort of see it. Yeah. I don't know where my character is.
We're gonna.
You're in the center of the bedroom. The center of the children's bedroom.
Right. Thank you. S for secret.
Don't worry, little kids. We're gonna go beat the monster. And
we're so scared. But maybe we can go with you in another way. Give me a charisma check, Brom.
Crom?
Crom.
Ah, charisma.
And
those attic horses again.
And yeah, the attic horses, and Tarnok.
Okay, just regular charisma check, not charisma save.
I'm super charisma.
That's a good point. It's charisma save.
Oh well, that's better than that then. If you take that d20, it's +6 instead.
So as they try to possess you, to go with you, unfortunately they cannot pass your. What's the word I'm looking for? Not faith, but you couldn't pass your charisma.
They're trying to possess us?
But yeah. You don't feel anything evil. It's more like abandonment issue. Because they've been locked in this bedroom to die by their parents.
Can you willingly
It's the only way they have to go with you.
I think they should possess Kirkle, and Kirkle should talk through them. The first time Kirkle will actually speak common.
As both the spears look at Kirkle.
I mean, I still wouldn't know what's going on.
You'd have heard your name twice.
Right? Oh, yeah. Good point. I'll ask Tarnok and Zephyr, what's going on? What are they talking about?
Oh, whoa. You can speak. I'm answering in Inferno.
Go ahead and give me a charisma check, Kirkle.
Talking to me?
Give me two, actually.
Sort of. What's that called? Charisma advantage?
Save. It's a charisma. No, just a charisma save. You need to roll it twice.
You are now possessed by Rose. You now have the character trait of I like being in charge and get angry when other people tell me what to do, and now you can understand common because felt bad for me. Thorn, on the other hand, because possessed by Rose first, did not.
Okay.
So at this point, from RP standpoint, you can understand what everybody's saying, and you have this character trait that you like being in charge. Get angry when
I
you
like
don't.
Being in charge. Angry when I'm not in charge?
Right. When other people tell you what to do. Yep.
Okay.
Oh, this frog's jumping into the lead.
The thorn.
Okay, so what should we do next?
Peppery.
Oh, the boy just disappeared, huh? Yep. I'll just start pushing through, I guess. Until I got to Crom, and then I'd say, you go first.
I'm in my mouth just opening it because this frog is talking to me.
Hello, everyone.
Yeah, and you can speak now, too. That's
and then after that, I pick up the frog and put him on my shoulder and say, come with me, little friend.
Nice.
Does she speak for him, or...?
So, how I'm envisioning it works, that she's possessed, and so there's a mental connection. She can understand your language, and she can speak through your language. So, it's kind of both. Tim...
I'd be like...
She's not taking full control.
Someone want a high ride?
I'm still trying to picture this Goliath with a 2-foot frog on his shoulder trying to squeeze through this little tiny spiral staircase.
Probably just looks like a blue turban Whee! On his head. Nothing spectacular.
It's like a piggyback ride, you know? But it's like a high ride where she sits on my the frog sits on my shoulders. It's kind of like Master Blaster, you know? The frog is in charge and it's telling where the Goliath where to go.
Yeah, go down.
We're going down.
All right, let me.
Come on, guys.
Hang tight. I gotta grab all you guys.
Oh, I said, come on, guys.
Oh yeah, we're
hang tight, garbage.
We're going.
All right, so you guys are walking down a spiral staircase, and like I mentioned before, it's like it passes through every story of the floor of the house, all the way down to almost 10 feet, 20 feet below the surface. A long staircase. You end up.
I think I fell down the stairs.
You're now into.
I think I'm dead.
Dungeon. And at this point, you guys go to level 2. Time to do it now.
Probably.
Yes, I do.
we have to take a long break to level up.
We have to take a long rest to level up. But
fine.
But I think I'm dead.
You should be in here.
Well, I mean, we could rest before we come down the stairs.
Well, it's not that. It's I forgot that Fizz is a talking frog.
We're all gonna.
Oh, yes.
That's right.
What happened?
What?
Fizz gives poison damage to anybody who touches him.
Yeah, and he picked me up and put me on his neck. It's like probably the worst.
Oh man, Brahm's got to give me something here. Hold on.
At very least, he's got the poison condition.
I need to pull up the source for Grungs.
That's disadvantage.
You see, this is what happens when you have a cute frog that's like, I want to take the lead.
Give
you
me
know,
a constitution saving throw.
So, by common rules of Grung, you start to become zombie-like and controllable by the Grung.
Ooh. So he.
Yeah, well, you like to be in control anyway.
Yeah. So you pick up this frog and put him on your shoulder, and you get a stinging feeling in your skin, but you're able to shake it off.
Nice. Oh. Good. It feels like Pop Rocks.
All right. Everybody back upstairs. Let's go take a rest.
So you creep down the secret stairs where once there was nothing, but now stands a thick black board.
Everybody
that leads
back upstairs.
Downstairs.
Can we retcon that we took a long rest? Sorry, I don't mean to interrupt.
Yeah, we can. We'll allow it. You go back
to a center room. And
you
not
go
in
back
this hallway.
You go back into Thorn and Rose's room, and you're able to take a long.
All right.
We'll let that
okay.
Loop. We'll push it through. If you guys want to take a moment, go ahead and level 2.
Are we doing standard leveling where we just add a locked no, I'm saying like a locked health amount? Or are we going to roll for it?
Are we doing max or average for
good point. Let's go max. Let's be simple.
Oh. Okay, so I got more hit points now.
Okay.
All right.
So how do you do that? 22, is that what it is? Total possible, or is it automatically go to max?
Should go to automatically go to max.
So there you go then. Wait, I would roll a d10, and it's max of that, right?
It should.
So it should be 10.
Yeah, plus your constitution modifier.
So it's not 18 then. Because I had 11.
Well, all right, you had 11, so your con modifier is 1.
Oh, it's plus your con?
My con is...
You're right.
Such a noob.
So I hit long rest, and it's not resetting my health points. Do I have to do something?
Click it twice. It'll ask you to re-click it again.
Yeah, it'll ask you to confirm.
Ah. And yeah, so from there,
your max hit point maximum is determined by the number you roll for your hit dice each level, or a fixed value determined by your hit dice and your constitution.
Yes, it's 1.
The potential values for you is total possible hit point is 22, average is 17, fixed 18.
So I should be at 22.
Yep.
Okay, so manage HP.
Can't really get into your sheet to help you guys when you're editing it because I don't mess you up.
Sorry.
I can now learn to speak with animals. Oh my god.
Let me guess, amphibians.
Right? I can now talk to fish. Try to get the fish to spell stuff out in the water.
So if I had 11 last turn, you said it's I get 10 plus my charisma, which is 3.
Only if your hit dice is a d10.
What's my hit dice?
What was?
It'll say in your character sheet. If you click on manage HP, it'll. What's your HP now? What was your HP at level 1?
11.
11, yeah, so you're probably a d10 plus 1 for charisma. Or for a constitution.
So he's got his hit die is a d8. He has potential.
His hit die is d8?
Yeah, so his potential possible is 22 with an average of 18, and his fix is 9. I'm going to say his max is 22.
So I hit level 2. And then it just automatically says, it says hit dice 2d8.
Yep.
That's your hit dice.
And then your constitution modifier is doubled also. Per level, you get a constitution modifier. So if your con modifier
is... it's a d8. So 22 is my HP then.
Yep.
Yeah.
So do I just hit override HP and then write 22?
Is it override or just add it in here?
You should be able to do it either way. You can override HP if you want, but you should be able to put in you should be able to put in 11 and just hit apply for your rolled number.
Yeah, let's try that. Let's go 16, 11,
right?
Apply. 17.
Well, it'd be 16 because the hit dice is 2d8, right?
That's correct.
2d8 plus your modifier.
He's right. Roll a 16. I just did it. You roll a 16. All your stuff will get added automatically. So you're.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. Oh, right. Because you're rolling. Yeah. Okay. Right.
Yep. So that should have stuck, Crom. Right. There.
Yeah. Mine's not updating my sheet. Like when I go from edit to the actual character sheet, it wasn't updating it. So I had to do an override. But it did it the same. It did the same thing. In Lost Mines, I think, or in this, I think I had to exit out of D&D Beyond and restart it to get it to do it.
Yeah, probably. But I'm actually watching Crom change. Are you doing it inside Roll 20?
I'm trying to do it, but it's just pain.
Yeah, and this still isn't
just
it still isn't updating.
Like I hit edit character and it just undid it. when I left edit character.
So okay, so what you do is click on your HP, click on your hit points up in the top, right? And then down in the bottom left, there's an override max HP. Just type 22 in there and just let it go from there, because it'll eventually. I think D&D Beyond is having an issue with that. Like,
it wouldn't be because your max box is filled out, is it? You're still at 13. Maybe that's why it's having trouble, because your max is set for 13 from level 20. Just guessing.
I have no idea. I mean, well, no, I mean, you mean Kroms?
All of mine. All of you just have your max added in.
All my stuff updated.
I just did mine manually, so.
I went in there and I clicked on my manage HP by double clicking max, and then I just did override max HP on the right.
We'll figure out the bugs on what's going on with the extension.
But, let's see, if I'm a level 2, that means I get a level, I don't know, it's level 3 is when I get cool stuff. Spells.
Speak with mosquitoes.
Yeah.
So as you guys are doing your level in there, I'll go ahead and read.
I have the, since we're doing a long rest, I'm going to, with my weapon, I believe it's my quarterstaff, I'm going to hug it dearly to me in order to use my, what do you want to call it? My, blessing of the forge.
Jay, what's that?
Your charisma.
At the end of a long rest, you can imbue magic into a weapon or armor by touching a non-magical version. Until the next long rest or you die, the object grants a +1 bonus to either AC or attack damage rolls.
All right, cool. All right.
So,
is there ever
been good? From what I understand, is this a permanent +1, or how does that work?
It's a +1 until you start your next long rest.
Well, I mean, it's or until I die, right?
Yep. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So it can be. Is it a permanent +1, and then just that's forever? Yeah.
Until your next long
only
rest.
Until you either die or you have the long rest, and then you can choose to enhance it again where it stays at the +1, or you choose to do enhance something else. Like, say you're doing a weapon, and say in that day of adventure, you find a new magical weapon. So once you complete your next long rest, then you can choose to, you know, enhance your, you know, standard armor, because you already have a magic weapon then, like that. But you can only have one or the other. You can only enhance one thing every long rest. And then it only lasts until you start your next long rest. And then it loses its, you know, magical enhancement.
Hmm.
All right, so everybody ready? Got their levels in?
Yeah, I'm good.
I'm ready to go.
My invocation's got my spells.
Okay, so
I'm still working on spells, but
level spells available, but you can cast lower level spells using your first level spell slot.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have any spells. How come I don't have any spells?
Well, you have to probably check them out, man. You had to add them.
How do I do that? I'm dumb.
If you go into your actions, there's spells, and then you can click add spells or manage spells.
Oh, how many of these do I get to do, too?
You
get as many spells as you have spell slots for. So how many first level spell slots do you have?
Do I get two? Prepared spells 0 of 5.
Oh, okay, so it tells you 0 of 5, so you get 5. There you go.
I think paladins work like a cleric, where they can pick out of a list every day.
I believe you can prepare any of the paladin spells after every long rest. So
That's
you're not
cool.
bound to just the 5 that you pick now. So
All right. So as you guys got your long rest in, you're feeling actually kind of stronger today, despite sleeping in a haunted house. But you did go send down the steps to the basement. Sparrow Yes. Tight staircase spirals down into darkness. Walls of mortared stone, cobwebs and dust are everywhere. Citizens of this cramped passage. Down and down into the depths you go. The shaft grows tighter and tighter. Air is stale, even bitter. Just as you can handle it no longer, just as your lungs are fit to burst, you find yourself in an archway that leads to a tunnel of carved earth and cold stone. Read. As you get down into the tunnel, you have a path left, you have a path right. It's also, I think everybody, did anybody bring the torch? Torch got extinguished.
Okay, so I'd like to say I took Devil's Sight as my invocation. I can now see through magical darkness, regular darkness.
Nice.
120 nice. Feet.
Yep. Devil's Sight's right. Awesome.
The Krom's that's remedied. Krom's the only one that doesn't have a torch. But what you... And your torch from yesterday was extinguished from the... I'll see from the time. But you hear an eerily ethereal chant throughout the entire dungeon. Impossible to gauge where the sound's coming from or whether they're even saying. Get discerned words from it, but I don't have a soundtrack to play it, but there's a chant. Rhythmic prayer, if you will. Throughout this entire thing. I had a little bit more upbeat music. How about this? All right.
Well, I guess I'll look at Kirkle and say, which way now?
I'm going to reach into my little backpack and chuck all my torches on the floor.
Okay. Dumped all the torches out.
Yep.
And I'm
gonna tell
him,
spread out, find the crypt. Let's do it quick, I want out of this place.
So as you look around, she says that the corridors Balfour's looking into right about here, and one in here from Tok's point of view. But with Tok, you can see down that hallway, look left and right, and you can get a glimpse of stone doors, if you will. And in Balfour's point of view, is to see the same thing. You get a path left and right, and on the edge of one, right about here, you see a stone door with the Durst, I believe it's Durst family crest at depth. Yes. Do you get an idea between, well, at least from Belfar, that you're sitting in the crypt? Tok, what you're seeing is basically carved out tomb with a ledge where a casket will sit, I guess a casket. But nothing is occupying this.
Okay, so I guess I'll say I have two empty rooms here that look like a crypt.
So
look like some kind of burial area.
Chuck the bones in there.
Barry, can you see anything yet?
I can see stuff.
Okay.
No, I don't. I can't see stuff. Kirkle can though. But do I need to see stuff anyways? Like,
you might.
To be honest.
You might.
I mean, I have a frog that can tell me what's in front of me.
Oh, fair.
So as Balfour moves
your shoulders,
as yeah,
Balfour,
you saw my shoulders.
As Balfour and Tarnok move closer, this one particularly has a name Thorn on it. This one has Rose etched in on the stone slab on the door.
Seems like the kids' bodies could go in here. It has their names on them.
I don't want to put the kids' bodies in there because then we'll lose the ghost.
Oh,
my frog.
Point.
My frog will become not a talking frog.
Yeah, and I gotta get off your shoulders because every single 6 seconds you'd be getting hit. I'm not. I would like you to be the cute, friendly frog, but I'm super poisonous.
Okay.
Are you?
I will deposit. I say, good job, Tarnok. You found the crypts where we can lay rest these bones. Right.
So as,
yep. Can we? Is there a way to open them?
Yep. As you open up, one of the Krom's in is Rose's crypt. The A coffin, stone coffin.
So with the possession, can I speak with her? I'm going to try. I'm going to try to speak with Rose and ask her if she'll stay with me long enough for us to loot this place. Long enough for us to explore. But she could probably read my mind. I don't know.
She can read it. Give me persuasion.
We could just leave Rose out. Put Thorn in.
That's what I'm asking, yeah.
Leave Rose on the floor here. And we can come back and do that on the way out.
Okay.
Don't give me a...
I think I rolled it.
Well, 10.
Yeah. It's like 50-50.
I could stay with you a little longer.
Just pretend we're playing.
Please don't forget to put... Just please don't forget to put...
Okay, cool. We won't forget to put you to rest.
I mean, she's probably been waiting to put really the rest for like 100 years.
She's probably also been waiting to be an awesome frog for 100 years. So, let's let her ride out this fantasy.
All right. So we're going to go... we're going to leave the body here on the floor so we don't have to carry it around with us.
All right, we'll see.
We still have the mother. Go this way.
We'll put Rose, in some respect, not in the hallway. We'll put her in her crypt and not in the, not in the casket. You put it in Thorn away?
Yes.
Ribbit.
Since you did that, Thorn appears and thanks you as he disappears. He's now at peace. You walk over to this side. Farnock does. And you're seeing... On the left side is Gustav's crypt, which you partake from the portrait is the father. Door shut. And Elizabeth's crypt is on the right. Okay, what you get to take is the mother of...
There's not... The one person is the nanny, so there's neither of those.
Oh, shit. Are you sure she's the nanny?
I don't know. Isn't there a picture with the Gustav?
Did she look like the mother?
Nope. She looks like the wife of Gustav in the family portraits.
All right, I'm curious. I want to open the crypts and see what's in.
All right.
If one's empty or not.
Yeah.
If you want to put the nanny's body in there, go for it.
That's not the nanny's body. That's the wife's body.
So Corgo looks into that. It's just a stone etched slab, etched with the Gustav Dors, his family crest symbol with the windmill, and has an empty coffin.
It's empty. And hers?
Etched in there, the crypt contains a stone briar with the empty coffin atop it. And as you walk into the room, I grab it. Swarm of centipedes starts pouring out the back wall.
Eat them.
Literally all the centipedes are going to eat this frog.
No, the frog can eat the centipedes.
Roll initiative.
Dun, 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 dun.
So you said that the body that we have, the woman that we saw upstairs looked like the wife, not the nanny?
Nope.
Wait.
So it looked like the nanny.
No. Looked like the nanny.
Okay.
The portrait.
The body we have.
The family portrait, man and woman, that you saw in the master suite as well as the fireplace downstairs, had the names Gustav and Elizabeth Durst. Right. The two crypts you see in front of you is left is Gustav and right.
You didn't
Elizabeth.
Reset the turn order.
Right. Okay. Right, but body that we have, whose body is that?
Oh. You did.
Does it look like the wife, or does it look like the nanny?
The body you have
is the nanny.
The skeleton that you now see in front of you looks like a skeleton.
Oh, great time for his mic to cut out.
Yeah,
I think it's the sensitivity in this.
The specter in the room that was stabbed in the womb was was the nanny. The skeleton in the bloody dress that we found should be her body.
Okay. The skeleton in the bloody dress that we found matched the doll.
What doll?
Okay.
The doll with the yellow dress.
Avalar, your mic cut out when you answered, so we didn't hear you.
Yeah.
Give me a history check, Corgi.
All of us?
Nah, just you.
Me? Good thing my history is not that great.
Well, you only got to remember 5 minutes ago, so it's not that bad.
It works. So, this is a family crypt. Most of the time, the nannies or non-family members do not get buried in the family crypt. The woman from the portrait from the master suite and the, I believe it was the family room when you first walked in, showed the man and woman with the name on it, Elizabeth and Gustav Durst. From that description, what you saw, the dress that she wore, her normal body shape, did not look to be the help. The specter you saw in her from her back, because you couldn't see her face, because when she did turn around, it was oozing off. That looked like more like a nurse maiden, like a nanny.
Right. Okay.
So put two and two together, this is a family crypt from that family with the seal from their family crest. The nanny would not be buried in with that.
Okay, right. So then there's two more questions. The body we found in the trunk, was that the nanny or the wife? And then the doll, was that the nanny or the wife?
And then so the body you found was in a white dress with stab wounds in her stomach, just like the wounds appeared to the specter that you saw. The two to two you put together, that is the body of the nurse man.
Okay.
All you found had a yellow dress. That's as what Grom's role basically just perceived, that was just basically a plate.
I think the wife is. Oh. I think the wife, the husband cheated on the wife, and the wife stabbed the nanny to death. That's just me.
I guess we shall
find
out.
That's just you, Crom, or that's just you.
Well, you know, we Goliaths are very sensitive to the ways of the world, okay, and also a crime of passion.
All right, Crom's got it. First turn initiative order as these centipedes are crawling all over the frog.
I did not. Talk to us.
Was the crypt empty?
That's right. Talk to us first.
For you first. Okay. Yep.
The wife's crypt, was it empty?
I can fix it. They're both empty, yes.
Okay, thank you.
I'm unaware, so you can skip me.
Okay. And that brings up the Quirgle, essentially.
What?
Oh.
Crumb.
What about me? It's okay.
I was gonna give it alright, we'll go to Crumb.
Let's see. I am going to save the frog.
You take poison damage.
I'm not gonna go. Now, Claire's question, can I be in his area without actually taking damage?
I was thinking the same thing. I think
he's
you
only
can,
2 feet tall.
I think you're not making skin to skin contact. You're not making
skin
to skin contact.
Well, he stands between my 4 foot legs.
That's disgusting.
Yep.
Don't look up, frog.
Don't look up, poor frog.
Yeah.
Look up.
He's just wearing a loincloth too. He's a Goliath.
What a Goliath wear under their
chest. I said was disgusting. Yeah.
Well, anyways, I'm going to do the spell?
Is that the DM typing?
I feel like it sounds like DM typing.
Bye.
I'm going to
keyboard. Good.
Yeah, I'm going to
Garrett.
Sacred Flame him.
Okay. Which bug?
The bug in front of me.
It's a swarm of bugs.
How many?
I'm just joking with you. I did not. So I take 3 radiant damage. So you shoot down and you hit a bunch of the centipedes, a bunch of them curl up and die. It took damage out of the swarm.
And then from there, let's see. I'm going to do Searing Smite and charge up my weapon for next turn.
Okay.
Searing
Smite as a bonus action?
Yeah.
I don't think you can cast two spells in one
that's
turn.
That's what I'm checking.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Is Sacred Flame a cantrip? Or no?
Yeah, Sacred Flame is a cantrip.
Sacred Flame is a cantrip, yeah.
Yeah.
But he uses action to cast Sacred Flame.
Searing Smite is a bonus action spell.
It is. He's right.
Then he can cast an action cantrip.
Correct. Searing Smite is a bonus action. That's what I was asking, if it was a bonus action.
Yep.
Yep.
So.
Okay. Yeah, so that would be allowed.
So you can cast two spells in a turn?
If it's bonus. Yes and no.
Cantrip's not a spell.
Well, a cantrip is a spell, but it's a level zero spell. That's the difference.
Breakdown is this. No matter cantrip, spell slot, doesn't matter. It's an action to cast a spell. The only time you can do a second spell is if you have a reaction or a bonus action. And whatchamacallit is a bonus action. You can't do a bonus action before your main action. That makes sense.
Yeah, but you can't. But regardless.
No, we changed that though. You can do a bonus action at any time.
You can do a bonus action before your action. Yes,
true. That's true. We did homebrew that in the Lost Mines.
No, I think that's actually general rule. Actually,
that's canon.
Either way, going back to Fizz's question, right? Going back to Fizz's question, you can't cast two level one and above spells, right? Like you can't cast a bonus action spell and then another level one and above spell, but you can cast a bonus action spell and a cantrip.
Because cantrips are level zero.
Cantrips are a level zero spell. So that's how that works.
So I beat your constitution save. I don't know if I take half damage or not. Without looking into your character sheet.
Huh?
Sacred Flame, it's not half damage.
No, it's not Sacred Flame, it's Searing Smite.
No, Searing Smite.
Searing Smite's for next turn.
Well, you cast it, though.
Yeah, you can cast it.
I'm confused. Smite. Next time you hit a creature with a melee weapon, attack during the spell's duration.
The Constitution save is when he actually when he hits you with it.
Oh, okay.
He's just saying he's prepping it up right now.
Gotcha. He rolled it like I thought he cast it, because you can.
Yeah, he rolled it.
Don't I have to roll it to initiate it? I'm confused on how you use it.
Okay, so because it's a bonus action, what you can do is you can actually do it on your next turn. So you can start your turn using your bonus action and then do the Searing Smite and then use your action to actually attack. Or you can do it at the end here. And it holds over because the spell lasts for up to 1 minute.
Gotcha. So it was a prep.
Either way.
But yeah, if you get hit in between your turn and next turn, you're going to have to roll a concentration check.
Correct.
Yep.
Yes.
Okay.
Gotcha. All right. So that means the Quirkle.
Hey.
Or, Quirkle.
I'm going to step. Nowhere. I'm gonna shoot first.
Okay.
Hey, don't look up.
He swings overhead,
and the Goliath falls to the ground.
Yeah, it's a fishing pole, too. It's gonna snag
Kirkle
on
raises
everything.
His staff.
Kirkle raises fishing rod.
Yeah, I don't even think this is legal, having two people in the same square.
Yeah, it is. Depending on the size, since you're small, anyone that's medium or large can actually share space with a small.
Cool. Okay. Somebody rolled something. Does that matter? No. All right. I'd like to use. I'm just gonna roll. Just gonna attack at it.
Wow.
What do you swing?
Water.
Swinging your fishing rod as a quarterstaff? That is a miss. So as you swing around, the centipedes spread out and form back in as your quarterstaff swings through, or your fishing pole swings. Miss. I'm going to speed it up just a tad, because I know Nils.
So now when you attack, is it going to hit both of us? Like, how does that work?
I only hit one.
Okay.
If you're staying put, I'm going to use a Tarnok. just gonna move it through a little bit, guys, so we can get this out of the way before us leave.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm good. I'm just staying in there.
Okay. So let's go to Zephyr.
Do I hear any commotion?
You probably hear sounds of a quarterstack hitting a stone wall and a searing flame just went off. Yeah, you hear some combat happening.
And then I instantly thinking, what are you touching in there? I guess I'll walk up to the corner and say that.
All right. The answer in free action. We're talking free actions.
Oh, cool. Yeah, there's centipedes over here.
Delfer?
Come down here, look. Look underneath Crom's legs.
Well, Balfour kind of just shrugs his shoulders at Zephyr.
Do you
going,
get it?
I don't know. I was standing right here.
Copy that. That brings it to... Go ahead.
That's going to be my turn.
All right, so that brings it to the swarm of centipedes who's going now rush into Quirkle, since he was the first one in the room, to do a bite.
You attacking me?
Against Quirkle?
Quirkle.
Yep.
Quirkle. Quirkle.
22.
Oof.
I use miss.
Ooh.
Yeah, you got me.
Okay. So, a bunch of centipedes
A
bunch of centipedes crawl up on the side of you in your... Well, you don't have hair. So, yeah, they crawl over your body, and they're all biting you for 12 piercing damage.
My God.
Ouch. Ow.
Oh, wait, now don't they have to do a constitution saving throw since they physically touched you for poison?
I don't know.
Oh.
Unless they have...
Yeah, it's. I believe it's
That is true. It's a bite. It's a touch. I do have to do a constitution saving throw, and I think it was 13 for what I read from the thing. 16.
Grung poison says 12 con. Hit DC is 12 con. DC 12.
He rolled a 16,
yeah.
So.
Okay.
So he rolled a 16. So
that's a good point. Though the traits for Grung say 13, but it might be bigger. So something else.
Well, but you're looking at the Grung. You're looking at the Grung stat block for the monster.
Yeah.
His player DC and stuff is going to be set by his player level and everything.
Gotcha.
Else, so.
Yeah. Gotcha. So what is that? 12? You said.
Yeah.
As I move to talk. Okay. All right. So I roll 16. We're still good there. It's all talk. Gets a sense of combat's happening.
I guess I'll walk down here and realize that they're in very tight quarters, and I'll just
you hear
no,
a Goliath
messing around
in
there.
You hear a frog and a Goliath grunting, and you hear lots of weird sounds of small little feet.
There's a frog and a Goliath in a closet grunting. I'm just going to go stand over here. quit mucking about in there.
Like it. I love it. Crom is up. as you now frog frame between your legs is covered in centipedes.
That's a little. Well, now it's all the centipedes are close between my legs, and I don't like it. So I am going to try to heal my frog friend.
Leon,
I can't cast another. I can since I'm holding that other spell, I can't cast another spell. Correct.
That's correct. You lose concentration.
Let's see what I can do. So
you can still do a cantrip.
Yes, I am going to. These things have these bugs been hurt yet?
Yes, by you.
Yeah. But hey, before you do anything, can I say one thing, Avalar, real quick?
Sure.
That might get overlooked. Okay, remember you did this during smite. That if I'm correct, let me see.
If you want to use that,
you have to use your action to actually physically attack them to apply the searing smite.
To apply searing smite, yeah, you have to make an actual melee attack, like a melee weapon attack.
Yeah, so I was planning to make the melee attack. I was just seeing if I had a bonus action for a cantrip, which I don't.
Yeah, there's like almost no cantrips that have a bonus action.
But the only one I know is the magic weapon one.
Oh, spirit's weapon, round. Yes, okay.
Like, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my staff, and I'm going to... All that fire is imbued into the staff.
Okay.
The magic and everything, and I'm going to smack at the... at these... Yes, right. Like, literally, I'm just, like, if I miss critically, it's going to be really bad.
So you got your... paladin charge mace from your deity. It's glowing as you swing down to hit these insects. Your fly swatter. That's right, your quarter staff, so I forgot about that.
Yep, it's the two-handed one.
You get a plus one on damage or an attack, huh? Or where's
yep,
your plus
I wrote
one plot?
Forge and I just put plus one on the plus on side. It would have gotcha. Been originally, but
gotcha.
It's 1d6 plus 3 or 1d8 plus 3.
All right, so as you
undo the two-handed.
All right, so as you swing down, they spread out as you hit solid stone floor, and as you pick back up, they swarm back in.
Nice.
Oh, that's a sad day.
So that's Kurgle as the centipedes pull off your body.
I'm gonna attack again.
Okay.
I'm gonna water blast. Rolled.
Nice.
Ooh. I guess I hit. Let me go back over there and roll damage. 3 points.
Okay. Do you? I don't know how you want to describe your spell casting, but
I'm just gonna open my
water blast.
yeah, and I'm jumping out of here. This is just so uncomfortable for me.
Okay. Yeah, maybe.
I imagine opportunity to attack, but I'm gone.
I'm shielded up. Yes. Sorry, I didn't say at the end.
Yep. Okay. So as your opportunity to attack as a 15. Try to pull out.
Yikes.
Never AC.
Bad words.
Well, not your AC. I'm going to get your AC, so what's your AC?
14.
I hit. Go ahead.
Go ahead. I just forgot to get rid of the exhaustion. I never took my long rest. That's all.
Okay. As you try to pull away, the swarm swarms up and bites you in your legs. It does hit, so it's 10 piercing damage.
No, my frog!
Down between his legs.
Alright, so you... You're actually at... Because of the way D&D Beyond 20 works, you're actually at 1. You're stable, but you are poisoned for 1 hour.
Wait, I don't take poison damage.
No, it's disadvantage on all attacks.
But he has immunity to poison.
In the poison condition.
Fair. Okay, you're just...
Down.
Yeah. That's interesting.
Do I even take that damage?
That's
a good.
Because it was a bite. It was a bite damage, but
they do have a poison effect.
Okay.
Take the poison effect.
Yeah.
So you are down. You are stable. You're just unconscious. The reverse effect is if you didn't have poison immunities, you would be paralyzed once you got woken back up. But you don't. Nice. You don't have that. You don't have that because you got immunity. So
I'm sure
just,
everybody's coming
which
up.
Which means now the centipedes have to do a constitution saving throw or they get poisoned.
Poison against poison.
As I see my frog friend fall, I say, help, my frog friend.
Well, does it have immunity to poison?
That's
I'm checking it right now.
Now, I got... I got charm, frightened, grapple, paralyzed, petrified, prone, restrained, stunned, nothing but poison.
No.
Okay.
Nope.
Yep, eat it.
But,
right.
So I'm 12, so I don't get poisoned.
Take a big bite of this poison-ass frog.
Doesn't affect
you. Rolled a 12?
I rolled 12.
My DC is 12. That means you pass?
Yes.
Okay.
Tarnak!
Okay.
This frog tries to make it out the door, and he basically falls collapsed right here.
Okay.
No longer between my legs.
The question is, did the centipedes come with me, or are they still in the square with Krom?
They can't pass me.
Yeah, still in the square. Still in the square before Krom.
Swarms can get on you.
That's correct.
They can occupy the same space.
Correct. I just haven't done it yet.
Okay. I I can go to here.
Don't tell me that.
I can pass you if I want to. Okay.
I can still attack with my glaive because that has 10 foot reach.
What, okay. Poke it between his legs.
How are you gonna? Cover. So you gotta describe how you're gonna get past Krom with this 10 foot reach.
Oh, I hear there's room between his legs.
He is pretty tall. How tall am I? I said I was like 6 foot.
You're probably
just don't squat too low.
I'm probably am I shorter than that? I don't know.
The tiefling I think is about six and a half feet tall.
Yeah, no, you're probably about the same size as me. 6'5", 6'6".
I'm just saying my mid center is probably 3.5 feet high.
I'll say real quick, Nil and Corgi, if you guys got to go, I'm gonna try to finish this encounter up, and then we're gonna close for the night. Bye. If you have to go,
okay.
No harm.
Okay. Yeah, no, I'm fine. How about instead of using the glaive, I'll cast Sacred Flame.
Yeah.
That'll be better.
Okay.
Help me burn these bugs up.
Sacred Flame it is.
Warm as chestnuts.
So that's a dex of 14.
Great.
You rolled a 21.
I rolled a natural 20.
Awesome.
Then it missed.
And, so the swarm moves around as the flame crashes to the cement floor, or stone floor. As it misses. I will quickly go through Sephir.
I guess I hear this commotion and come down the hallway and see that this is like a mess of things. And it's kind of tight, so I'm just gonna hang out here and hold my action if they come out into the hallway.
Okay. Probably make a shot between his legs.
That goes to Bell. Natural one, please.
Not in the grapefruit.
Does anybody roll a natural one when they're trying to shoot through Krom? I gotta. I'm just saying. I'm gonna hold it just in case.
Krom's not having kids.
Balfour's turn.
Alright. Balfour's gonna come here, sees the fact that the frog is on the ground, basically unconscious, and nobody's paying any attention to him.
I stood on top.
Tarnok's kind of stepping over him, but.
He sat on him like a mother hen.
Yeah.
I just killed him for 12.
Thank you. I could have done that. I was trying to get rid of the danger first.
Thank you so much.
And then I'm going to just back up to right here, and then that is going to end my turn.
All right. Swarm of centipedes are going to reach out, crawl up on Krom, and bite.
TPK by centipede.
14.
Nope, better than broomstick.
Alright, so it doesn't get through on this time, and then they pull back down.
But I'm screaming like a little girl.
Get him off me! Get him off me!
Talk!
Oh, God. You know what? I'm not even gonna bother going in there, because it's so jam-packed in there. I'm just gonna be like, would you knock it off and get out here?
All right.
I bet he's trying to knock it off.
Now, are the centipedes on me right now?
I'm trying to flavor it up, man. They're a swarm in front of you. They're reaching out to attack you. I'm just trying to flavor it so they're not on you. No.
Oh, I was going to say, if they're on me, my character would try to run out the door with them on him and run through.
Yeah. So when they attack and they try to bite you, they're gonna crawl on you to try to bite you. That's how I'm picturing it. So yeah, they were on you. They're all
running around. I want to. Can I go to right here?
Sure.
Can I push through him and go to right here and be spinning around?
Yeah. Don't forget, you can move through your allies' spaces.
Yeah. Well, I'm saying take the centipedes with me.
Grapple.
No, it doesn't work that way.
No. Okay.
Just trying to flavor.
Wow. Where'd I go?
How'd you move all of us? That was cool.
He boxed you in by left clicking too much, too held in left click.
Okay. I guess the only thing I can do is try to set them on fire. Have they been damaged yet? Or yes or no?
Twice, maybe.
Yeah, yes, they have.
Okay, yeah. So I'm going to Toll the Dead then. Because that's like a pretty good one.
Wisdom?
Yeah, wisdom.
I failed.
Ding.
You hit
ding. Ding.
As you told the dead of your patron, your deity bell ringing thing, as I'm reading stats real quick just to make the resistance communities. Yeah, I'm good. 7 damage. Boom. So you have the shadow energy just starts killing, and more bugs die off.
Okay, then I'm going to move to here, and I'm going to shield up. Actually, I can't move to there, because I don't want them to get an opportunity attack. I have to stay here. God damn it. I'll stay here and shield up.
That's incorrect, Syntex. They're not vulnerable to AoE. Incorrect, but you do notice that there's it looks to be half the size it was. All right, Kurgle is back up, conscious, not paralyzed.
All right, so I'm gonna come up from prone and stand.
And Rose is in your head going, "Don't get me killed in this body."
Be careful down there.
We'll be tied together forever.
More or less.
That would be crazy.
Well, you're. It's a 5-foot by 5-foot square. You can stand in front of me. You don't have to be directly below me.
Alright, so...
Can you imagine a ghost inside of a ghost?
Inside of a ghost house?
I'm just saying, that's like Inception ghosts.
Their souls would be intertwined forever.
Ever and ever, as Rose warns Quargle in his head as he's... What are you doing?
I'm going to water blast.
Water blast.
Yep.
Do frogs even have souls?
Between Tarnok's legs, between the flame walker's legs.
As you spew this water,
oh,
you just got Brom's pants
everybody wet.
You just got everybody wet that's in front of you. They're now soaking wet.
I'm behind you.
Hey, Jenna, I'm leaving.
You said we can say things to other people as a free action, even when it's not our turn and stuff, correct?
Correct.
All right. Well, as this is going on, I'm also at the same time, I'm going to be saying, you know, do what you have to do and get out of my way.
I already left.
But of course, I can't get over there right now.
Yeah, I left.
All right, so Tarnak dripping wet now from the waist down.
That's also for Tarnak as well.
It's your turn.
My turn?
Yeah.
Okay. So, I will toll the dead.
All right.
It's gonna look like they pissed themselves.
Hey, I'm not happy right now. I had a frog.
That's
it died.
I mean, it's got a DC of wisdom, say wisdom 14.
There you go. 14. So you try to do the call of dead, and it doesn't affect the swarms at all.
Now, Tarnak, get out of my way.
I'm moving to out there. I'm done. I'm done with the centipede.
Sephir's watching a frog go by him and a dripping wet Tarnak.
I ring my bell, too, and it doesn't do anything.
As Bilfer's telling everybody to get out of the way.
I hear him say that, and I will stay out of his way.
Top of that, it says Bilfer.
You won't even attack and then go back?
I'll hold my turn if they come out into the hallway.
Alright, Timber.
Alright. Balfour's coming here to the corner, and since there's a guy in front of him that's like the same size he is, he drops down like he's kneeling and everything like that, and he sees the centipedes in between his legs.
Okay.
And he does...
Whoa, that's not a centipede.
That.
Hey!
And remember, that's times 3, so that's gonna be 9.
Ooh!
He casts Magic Missile at the Darkness.
Boom, boom, boom.
Boom, 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 boom. Hit every single centipede. It just dies off.
Nice.
Oh, good. Oof.
Oh, thank you. I hug him.
You could have shot thank magic missile from back
thank
there.
You. Thank you. Thank you so much for
you saving had to see
me.
The target.
That's why I had to wait, because
it's one of those pesky, see. You know, have to see what you're shooting at kind of spells.
Whole, like line of sight thing, you know?
Oh yeah.
I got
oh, yeah.
Ball I got Fungal Lord wet right. too.
So this is where we leave the party after a fight with centipedes who left two dripping wet party members and knocked well, it was a knocked out frog, now he's back. And yeah, everybody's pride's a little hurt,
and,
I think.
And Archeliah just had three magic missiles go right in between his legs.
Correct.
Okay. I skin him. No. wrong character.
wrong. You get one insect leg. But with that, guys, we're going to end the session for tonight. I'm starting to find a good
one. Oh,
cool.
Nice.
Awesome. Oh, but so speaking leg. About skinning them, I'd like to grab them for bait and possibly to get poison out of them.
Okay.
Yep.
They're not poisonous. Well... You know what? Well, we'll talk about that. We'll talk about that. They have a poison bite to paralyze. We'll talk about that. Have a great day. Yes, you could pick up, let's say, I don't know.
Some
I mean, I don't know how to judge the quantity. You get a handful, a couple handfuls of them.
Do a, what do you want to do? Do a D20 roll?
Oh, yeah, it could be D20. I mean,
yeah,
one of those and how many he gets. That one's still intact.
Yeah, I mean, that sounds good. Do D20.
Do what? Okay. Yeah.
Everything else got burned up by the sacred flame.
There we go.
And magic missiles.
There you go.
13 something.
And magic missiles. There you go.
Yep.
You probably can extract. Money? We can talk about spending some time on your Lex long rest. You can extract some of the poison out of it for a paralyzing thing.
Mm-hmm.
We'll set that.
I got a guy who does poison stuff.
Let's set that DC. Well, I remember. Let's set that DC for that paralytic poison at. Well, this is give me one. Let's say 13.
Oh, okay, let me write that down. DC 13, and it just paralyzes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Paralyzed for 1 hour.
Paralyzed an hour. Okay, yep. Wrote it down.
So with that, guys, we end our session for tonight. I hope
awesome.
You like the. I hope you like the pace. I just quote unquote speed it up, but
yeah,
that's good.
I gotta
I
say,
know, I mean, like,
it
this dungeon was a little tough because of the cramped quarters, but I mean,
yeah.
So it's the nature of the map.
All the really slow discovery of weird things, and it's all
and the monsters
puzzly.
Are super hard.
Well, all right, the monsters are very cool. I like puzzles, but I'm used to like a puzzle room. Not like
okay,
the whole
well, the,
world
okay,
is a
but the issue, okay, the issue with the puzzles in this game is they're not so much puzzles. Well, they're clues to things that may be relevant
later
in
on.
The future.
So are we like over examining everything? You think?
No, we're learning things as we go. We are probably under investigating, but. There's you're learning certain things, like you're learning about the Durst family, you're learning, you know, the different symbolism throughout the game. We got the letter from Strahd. You know, we're learning different backstories that may tie into a bigger story as we go on. So it's think
okay, so it's,
like
you said
clue
like
before, right?
Yeah.
So you said clue before, so it's basically the same thing. Is you know, like someone killed someone with the candlestick in the library, right? And you have to go through everything.
This campaign isn't go into this room, kill a bunch of stuff, go into the next room, kill a bunch of stuff, go into the next room. That's not how this campaign.
Correct. The story is driven from the environment and the flavor text and your perception. What have we learned so far with the Thirst House? Right, you already got a letter about a cult. Too, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you hear chanting in the dungeon, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's stuff like that. Yeah. So it's a flavor, it's a psychedelic type horror. You already kind of met the nurse maid, the nanny.
It's trippy, and it freaks me out. Like
it gets weirder.
Oh, it gets
if you've seen one episode of Jerry Springer and Cheaters, you know what's going on.
I'll put this in perspective of how the rest of the campaign is going to play out to a degree from the storylines. Basically, this is an appendix run a side option run if I decide to ran you at level 1. The actual campaign starts at level 3. So okay. I choose to run this to start you at 1 because I think it's a nice introduction to what you're going to see further, but it's going to
Night, Corgi.
Really go out. Night, Corgi.
Bye,
Corgi.
Corgi.
Bye, Corgi.
So the story's bye. Really going to... really. Oh, I'm sorry. Bye, Corgi.
No, bye.
Which, so it's really going to expand out into when you get to the lands of Barovia. This is just a taste of what you're going to... you're right. The monsters are tough. That's what I'm saying. They're the counters... Think about your encounter. Some things you just can't get away from. You have to go to combat. But think about your encounters. You're going to walk into places and you're going to see something. We're going to roll initiative. You choose whether to attack it or not. You're right, with the Spectre. If you choose to fight that, that's your choice. It probably would have killed both of you. At least two of you.
I mean, there are very easy situations to get into in
killed
this.
Killed all of us. It's not like I could jump out the window. You know, like...
Well, yeah, but there are going to be situations as we go through this where it's going to be very easy for us to get above our challenge rating very quickly.
Oh yeah.
And all of a sudden we're getting murdered.
Yeah.
I'll say this as a DM.
TPKs are possible in this campaign.
Well, luckily there's like 3 healers in this crew.
Yeah, and that's really good. I would have sacrificed a rogue to keep your 3 healers. I'll say this as a DM, trust me with your players though. If it does get caught in a situation where you do die, we'll have your backup, but trust me with your players. I'll take care of your players. You put a lot of effort and backstory into them. So.
Yeah, but I'm just saying, you know, choose your battles.
Mm-hmm.
Is what I'm saying. Like, you know, there's no shame in talking your way out of something or just saying I'm walking away from it.
Yep.
Because it's
yeah, very much so. Yeah. Very much so. It's a different type of campaign than one. I'll be honest with you, I'm used to. Playing and running, that's why I liked it so much. I think it's why it's one of the popular ones out there, because it's so much thick with mystery. It's vampire-ish, right? It's like this whole gothic scenario mystery. This was stuff I'm trying to soften a little bit because there is some pretty horrific stuff for content wise in here. there's a lot more with the nanny with how she's described and. Flavoring the story to you what happened with her, and I was like, man, I'm not gonna read all that. I'm not gonna go into that. It's you might have somebody that's very sensitive to that. I don't want to get into it.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I think you got a gist of what happened there.
You did well.
But yeah, there's some more mystery with the Durst family. We got a letter from Strahd talking. The letter. I hope you all remember the letter. I posted in Discord too. What you found in that chest.
Yeah. And the letter was good. To Gustav, right?
From Gustav. I think by now you got the feeling he called it a mispathetic servant, but I think you got an idea that Gustav was the attendant recipient of that letter. No, he talked about what he was trying to do to win somebody's favor. If you read that letter, it's a very flavorful game. I hope the pace is fine. I could speed it up a little bit. I knew you were going to get jammed up on that lock because it was last week when you found the key. I don't know how easy you're going to connect that.
I knew the whole time about the key, and I'm just like, but I wouldn't know as a character. Actually, I can't tell him. I
you're right.
Know.
I couldn't remember who found the key, so I was going to...
It wasn't me. I was like was four... Talk. I was on the balcony outside. Like.
Yeah, yeah.
It was talk. I totally forgot. And like, all right, so I have, I literally have a steno pad sitting right here on the desk.
I gotta go.
And it's written, right at the top of the page, iron key with a circle around it.
It's like White Wolf's Vampire and Masquerade. I would say it's probably like a touch of Bram Stoker of gothic feel with a little bit of Clue. Not so much the murder mystery part of it, but just the, you're all don't know each other. You're got into this land. You don't know why you're here, where you're at type thing. And then add the flavor of the Gary Oldman's Bram Stoker Dracula. There's probably other comparisons we can do as you get into the game. This is obviously the Death House for a reason. It's actually a popular one shot by itself.
Yeah.
But I'm really glad that before we came down, we did hit level 2 because I had a whole ton of other stuff, you know, that, you know, my character has. And it's not all, you know, hey, offensive magic. I have a whole ton of different things for utility. That's why I'm building this character the way
that's
I
good.
Am.
That's a good point. It's especially in, through this entire campaign. It's not just about the attack, it's about the utility. I have that mentioned too, is that this particular one, this death house, I'm gonna, it's milestone leveling, just to get you to 3. So when you finish this, you'll be 3. After that, it'll be back to how I do Lost Wines, where I will try to feed you experience points to kind of milestone you, if that makes sense. So you'll get something. I like to believe you get something a little bit out of everything you do, but I don't want to push level you because it'll mess me up trying to, as you follow the story.
Yeah, and that's fine.
Which reminds me back to Lost Wines. As we finish that up, wrap that up, I might have to hold you back a level because Stranger Things really messed me up as I went and reread the next segment. If I pushed you to level 6 now, I had to like rewrite half the module. Which, but it's all you're doing there is just stuffing monsters and by quantity. So you lose a little bit of story.
Or you can up their challenge rating. Just, up their.
Yeah, well, I was thinking about that, like just changing out some things and doing certain things with the
challenge ratings. Just take a monster build that has like the same kind of effects that kind of do the similar type of thing that it could possibly do, and instead it just looks like this thing. That's all.
Yeah, that's possible. I could probably do that. The whole thing that messed me up is that I was thinking for some reason the Wave Echo K was at level 5. No, it was level 4, and you leveled to level 5 afterwards. Yeah. So I pushed you to 5. Now you're going to finish off technically at 6. Like, oh man, that really messes me up. So I had to CR rate you 2 levels above from your starting quest and then the next one. So I'm actually taking 2 out, which is okay. I introduced it in a couple sessions back. I think it's in your quest logs, but I might just like, hey, they're, I'll come up with something. It was the known place and it was the Dwarven Excavation. You had to go rescue them. Your favorite adventure is the Temple of Elemental Evil. Let's kind of know that one, man. But that does bring another thing too. I think I brought mentioned something to Ed earlier. We were talking to him in private Discord. So there's a lot of quote-unquote expansion one shots out of this, and I have some in my portfolio, if you will. I love the show to Ed, but he's playing the game. I don't want to ruin, spoil anything. But there's some great one shots from the flavor of this campaign. I must have got at least 15 of them because people. I'd say it's one of the popular ones. So there's a lot. There's a writer on DM Guild, I think it is, that he just wrote like 13 one shots just from the flavor. So there's different areas of this lands of Barovia, and he expands the story and created a one shot out of it. So
there are entire campaigns that are written like after this, right?
That's true.
Or campaigns that are written alongside of this, like you're still going up against Strahd, but you're not dealing with the same stuff that's in here. There's people that have written full campaigns that run parallel to this.
Yep. It's great. It's a lot of information.
They've made it like a really big open-ended adventure. It's literally, you can choose this, and if you go and redo it, it's like, okay, do this, but then, it's like those choose your own adventure books. You made a different decision. Guess what? That brings us to a whole different way you play the campaign, because you're going down a totally different road.
Yeah. Well, I've seen. All right. So one of the I try not to watch too much of it because I knew we were going to be playing it. But one of the streamers that I saw actually had 2 parties, and he was running Strahd on one night, and he was running this other Strahd-like campaign on another night, and he had 2 parties of 4 adventurers each, right? And they worked parallel all the way up till Strahd, and then all 8 of them went up against Strahd together.
Oh, that's cool.
That's cool.
Oh, nice.
So he had 2 parallel parties, and everything that each party did in their own campaign affected the other party.
Oh, that's
cool.
That's
a great idea. It was kind of like a persistent, like Barovia was persistent. So if they did something like if they burned down a building on Thursday night, it affected the guys on Tuesday night.
Oh, that's awesome.
Right. So, but it was it was 2 parallel campaigns, but they were 2 completely different campaigns. It was really cool the way he did it.
That is awesome.
That would be cool to do that and then combine them at the end to join up.
Yeah.
All decisions are going to affect the other one. Yeah, that'd be cool.
Hey, Neil, if you Yeah, check out Bully's stream out, man. I think that piece looks really good. If you
alright, on 1 second. Yeah, well, I'm here. I have to relaunch everything because, like I said, middle, everything went down on me. Like, every program I had, like, shut down. 1 second, Bully. I didn't even bring Twitch back up, so I'm bringing it up now.
Pretty weak, guys. See if we can debug some of this beyond 20 extensions. I can go in each one of your characters, but I don't know if it's something I'm doing or I don't know. That might be a bug. That's hard to pull off. Yes, and that is. There's another guy just does that. I think he has like, I'm just quoting, 15 campaigns, not just
those
him.
Both look really nice. I like both of those.
Not just him DMing, but he has other DMs that DM his world. That's great,
awesome.
Man.
A shadow sniper, and then you know. The Nil that the whole group, you know, knows and loves.
Yeah, that's the mighty Nil. The great and powerful Nil.
The great. Are you a good dragon or a bad dragon?
Who's that?
You'll have to find out.
I'm just saying is that he's a black dragon, and chromatic and non-chromatics are.
Yeah,
like, a black dragon would be a bad dragon.
Okay. I gotta take 360 views of both of them, and then I'll send them out.
Okay, really good.
Yeah, no, they both those look great, dude.
Hey, you know what we should do next, Bully?
What?
Avalar.
Yours? Okay, nah. I can't. I have to do Fula. I have to do Fula again.
I'm patient, man. That's more of a display.
And then I'm gonna.
That's more of a display. I'm patient.
It's right here.
Okay.
I'm gonna Zenithal highlight him. I have a second one right
away. You're good, man. I would just pick. I just need to push Strahd because I want to play that with the family. We're gonna make up. Girls gonna get on, make their characters in Hero Forge, and
I got my polarizing sheet.
I'm sorry, I was muted, guys. I'm talking to you. I was muted.
I saw you moving up there on the. I was like, oh, he must have been muted talking to his chat, but I didn't see chat moving.
So Farrah asked about Tok, right? So I am not a chromatic dragon. I'm not a black dragon. I'm a Ravenite dragonborn. So, don't assume anything by me being a black dragonborn. I'm a chaotic neutral fighter, Ravenite dragonborn.
Chaotic neutral. You don't seem very chaotic.
Okay.
Not yet.
You've only barely known him.
Yeah, he's been in one room, and he did run in and get hit in the head with a broom.
All you've seen so far is my neutral side.
I'm just saying, what I see is that you like you come off as this badass born in the fighting pits of some dark otherworldly dimension, and when you opened up the closet and I let go of a small Swiffer, you died.
Sin,
you opened up the closet and let go of the Swiffer.
Syntax, I normally don't really pay attention to alignment too much. That's a good idea with the reputation. I kind of work that same way with how to interact with the townsfolk or NPCs, but this run particularly, I'm going to pay more attention to not only your alignment, but how the player interacts with their alignment. I can't tell you why, but I'm going to be... I'll just say this, Strahd sees everything.
My character is like I can tell you about it, but pretty much is that I'm an alcoholic, I'm a little bit of a coward, but I am obsessed with shiny things.
Okay.
Like that's kind of like my thing. I like because it's just my faith where I get my powers from, for my cleric. It involves smithing, so it's like I'm always looking for the next cool gizmo and gadget.
I tell you this. You brought up a good point. I love the alcoholic background because I think it's pretty open. Strahd sees everything. Very up in front and personal. Big boss of a campaign that you're going to meet basically on day one, essentially. And he uses things against you. Think Bram Stoker's Dracula. He's a very charming vampire. He knows how to get into where he wants to go. So, and he's probably going to know your background. If you got moments throughout this before we get done with Beth House, if you want to fill out your background part in the D&D Beyond, that'd be helpful for me to try to roleplay with you.
All I have is my my character traits, my ideals, my bonds, and flaws. But I can also put in some other things.
Backstory, there should be a notes section, I think.
You're talking about the background?
Yeah.
If you go into the character sheet, I just closed it all out. Let's see.
Yeah, backstory.
There's description, and there's also
backstory,
notes.
Description, there's all that in there, right?
So yeah, you under notes is backstory.
And the other thing with that is you can type that all out in a Word doc or whatever and then copy paste it.
Character is just he doesn't really like humans that much and or elves that much.
Interesting.
They're not even though he more or less his whole like family slash clan were killed off and he was an orphan. Finds that humans are nice to other humanoids but not people who are looking different.
Okay.
So
Syntax says in the older version of the game alignment wasn't more important, but the last two editions there's very little to deal with, and that is correct. That's correct. I think I can't speak for anything beyond third edition because I didn't play 4. I just got in 5 years.
I didn't play 4.
Yeah. I heard it was actually a terrible.
Yeah, that's what I heard.
Even back in third edition, we did a lot more custom campaigns. There was a few pre-mades I did, but I always use alignment that way because you put that in there, but your player's going to play it how he wants to play in a given situation that's presented to him. I hate to say it boxed into what you put on the paper. You know, especially some of the campaigns can last over a year, you know, which you wrote 12 months ago, so your characters can change. So I look at, like you're saying, more reputation. I think that's more plausible and more realistic. It's almost like I want a 30 alignment part out. Say, hey, give me a basis where you stand, but your reputation, how you're going forward, is going to how you interact with the world that we create. So I really like the reputation.
I really wanted to make my character slightly linked with dragons, but the fact that we appeared randomly and we didn't know each other made it kind of like not possible. So
yeah, fair. Yeah, I thought about different ways how
I'm gonna pop off here for tonight.
All right, no.
Everybody. Take care, guys.
I thought
have a good one.
I thought various ways of how to bring in the party, and there's the standard hook that was y'all meet in a tavern and some stranger comes in, and there was another one about you guys got lost in the woods or something but you already knew each other, and I'm like, I didn't like none of that. I thought it was kind of unique that you come in, you're picked up at your I don't want to give it too much away, but you fell asleep in your separate areas and you woke up somewhere different, surrounded by people you do not know. So I was thinking in that terms that you guys will RP that to a degree, like you don't know each other.
It reminds me of Predators.
Something like that, yeah. And you could be very suspicious of your party members. I like that dynamic of it. Because Strahd's going to throw some stuff at you and you might think it's another player doing it.
In the movie Predators, there was a guy who was a serial killer, but you thought he was like a doctor teacher. You know, it's like...
I will say this, there's some players to DM communications going on for secrets. So, very real of that dynamic, that there's going to be things happening that you think it's might be your own players, your own party doing it. That was the idea. Strahd by nature is going to pit you guys against each other, and there's a reason for that. That'll come out in the story. In the fourth edition, I loved the movement with your abilities and powers. It was much more fluid to combat. You know, I skipped fourth edition. I should go back and probably read that. I'm curious. I'm very curious because it was very clunky in the third edition. I got introduced to battle maps and minis at the time. Before that, I was the second edition or advanced Dungeon Dragons. I was playing more Theater of the Mind.
So here's a question. With the fourth domain, do I get... Besides the +1 AC or damage, depending on whether it's armor or weapon, Does that ever get better, or is it just one AC and I just have to choose it for one?
Like, well, let's look at the spell, time. Right? You talking about the
my divine power,
Searing Smite you cast? Is that the one you asked about?
Nah, the let's see here. If you go to, I guess, features and traits, and you go to my divine, our blessings of the forge.
Okay.
If that's my like channel divinity. I think, right? Or no? Is that?
So at the end of your long rest, you can imbue magic into a weapon or armor by touching it, touching a non-magical version. Until your next long rest or you die, you grant plus one. Bonus to AC or damage. You can. So this comes out of the source book's coming out of Xavier's Guide to Everything. Xanthar's Guide to Everything. So let's go there to the source. And let's read what it does. And I took it for granted, but since you're part of the campaign, okay, you have access to all our stuff that me and Ed has.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
All right, so absolutely. It's a paladin. It's not an Oath of Conquest.
Cleric?
No, it was a cleric. Sorry.
Of the Forge class?
Okay, so let's go there. On it. At first level, you gain this ability. Okay, so no, that particular... Okay, so that particular feature is only one to AC, one to bonus, but as you go down, you notice the Soul Forge versus the Blessing of Forge, it turns into a Soul Forge. Starting at 6th level, you mastery the Forge, grants you special abilities. You gain resistance to fire damage while wearing heavy armor, you gain a... And then you got a Saint Forge and fire. So it changes the name and certain other thing. It's a more of a layering effect, right? No, the plus one doesn't move, but you do get a fire resistance at 6th level with another plus one to your AC.
Oh, that's cool.
At 17th level, you get immunity to fire. And while you're wearing heavy armor, you have resistance to bludgeoning, piercing, and slashing damage. So it's kind of a layering effect of how they work that. That makes sense? That makes sense a little bit?
But getting to level 17 is easy. Channel Divinity, the Artisan's Blessing. I can create arrows and other things.
You can create, use Channel Divinity to create simple items.
It says martial weapons, a suit of armor, 10 pieces of ammunition, a set of tools, or another metal object. Like, let's say keys.
Yeah, so you conduct an hour-long ritual and you craft non-magical items that must include some metal. A simple or martial weapon, a suit of armor, 10 pieces of ammunition, yeah, set of tools, metal objects, yep. Xanthar's Guide to Everything was the awesome addition to our source books. That and Tasha.
I'm just trying to think of what I could copy.
Yeah. I'm sorry, what?
Like what?
No, you're actually making it. It's not a copy per se. You're actually crafting it.
Well, if I had the original, and I'd be like, looking at it, and then I would just, I could be one of those key machines, and
yeah,
take
but
me an hour.
But nothing saying, yeah, okay,
well,
yeah.
I see what you say with the copy, right? So there'd be
nothing saying that you couldn't actually make a key to fit a lock either. So,
well, as I was saying, the ritual can create a duplicate of a non-magical item that consists of metal that's not martial or weapons or anything like that, such as a key. If you possess the original, you can make a copy.
Okay.
That's a pretty cool thing, man. Artisan Blessing, I like that.
Well,
the thing you can create can be something that is worth no more than 100 gold pieces. And as part of the ritual, you must lay out metal, which include coins, the value equal to the creation. So you have to find metal, silver, gold, of at least equal value. Yeah, that could do with dumb copper. But you have to lay out metal that's... value to its creation cost, from like say from armor metal. they're still putting a money.
it'd probably be
excuse me
the dragonborn, and I'd probably go up to him Yeah, he'd fall asleep, and then every single morning he'd wake up with less metal on his armor, and he'd be like,
"Yeah,
where's all the metal going?"
You think that would do
I'm
that?
I'm wearing leather.
Oh.
With reputation, we had it set up in five levels, both positive and negative, and gave it different benefits. So they would be RP stuff sometimes. Others would be rewards, powers, gain, but that was rare. And then this one has level 5 positive with the druid sect, while they're within their forest, overland movement was increased. Okay. And the chance of random encounters would be impressive.
So, please describe this. I have this thing called Stone's Endurance. As a reaction, reduce damage dealt to you by 1d12 plus 3 per short rest.
Oh,
so,
that's cool.
Does that mean I have to invoke that Stone's Endurance as a reaction? So if someone tries to hit me, I can be like,
yep.
Stone's Endurance?
Yep. So, once per short rest.
Yep.
Yeah, so say you take like a really heavy hit, right?
That would probably kill
me? You're going to take, well, regardless, right? Maybe yeah. even knock you down like really low. Like say you take a really heavy hit. You can say, I'm going to use my Stone's Endurance, or I'm, you know, and then that's, you get to roll, what was it, a d12 or something?
d12 plus 3?
Yeah.
Just to bring it to my screen, everybody, on my stream, this is what I'm looking at. This is what he's looking at, and this is what he's talking about. It's for my people on my stream. So this is an Elemental Evil Player's Companion. What's that? This is coming from that source. Okay. That is correct. So you can focus yourself into occasional struggle of energy. Now, what I mostly know about reaction, things of this nature, you have to declare it first, I believe.
Well, I mean, it says as a reaction,
no,
reduce damage dealt to you.
It's basically the same as a rogue using uncanny dodge or Kindruck using shield. It's just a reaction.
So okay, it has to be. I mean, I have to be damaged first, and then it's more or less I just absorb the damage, I guess.
Well, no, you'd have to take damage, right? So basically,
that's what I'm saying. I have to be damaged first. Like if someone says, deal 5, or they say deal 22 damage to you, and I say. I like to do my Stones of Endurance reaction, or react within Stones of Endurance, or something like that. And then from there, I roll a dice, and then I negate that damage.
Correct. Yeah, but you're not actually taking the damage, but it's somebody has to deal damage against you. Yes.
Yeah, I mean they can't barely hit me, or I mean like not hit
yeah,
me, but,
I mean. Break it down to segments. Your trigger and effect is when you take the damage, and then you can roll for your reaction.
It's the same as when I cast shield, right? If somebody hits my AC, and I can say, all right, I cast shield to block it, and it adds 5 to my AC.
Now, it is a potential that you can roll and absorb all of the damage and not take any at all, but the trigger first effect is somebody did damage to you, then that will apply. So you can potentially, yes, not take any damage.
What that about that now here's a question. Did that when that lady was sucking the souls out of me or the life out of me, was that damage?
Yes. It's technically in there.
It was necrotic damage.
Yep.
Okay.
I think with that, guys, I'm gonna head off for the night, Glenn. I'm gonna close my stream. Right, but dude. Like I said, I hope you really enjoy it, even your audience. I hope you really enjoy it. And I can always increase the pace if it's going slow. No problem.
Going to bed. It's always slow. First and second level are always slow. So
It is. It'll speed up when you get into some other stuff going on. But actually, I didn't mind the pace. You guys are working through it. I came back. You guys are you're talking through some of the stuff you found.
I got my action surge now, bro.
Yeah, you did. Actually, I like that you guys were discussing the clues that you're finding. You know, table talk or not, that's the idea of the campaign, so I'll let it go. Because you're talking through mentally what you saw, how to apply it, what's going on.
Yeah, you gotta assume that we're talking all the time, actually.
So the issue with table talk, right, especially in a stream setting, right, so the issue with table discussions, right, is when the DM is muted and listening to every word that we say.
Yeah. Not...
Well, that's fine.
On purpose. Yeah. I was trying to interact with you. Yeah, you're right there. No.
Well, no, because I'll tell you, I mean, in the past, table talk has gotten, you know, me and other people I know in trouble, you know, because you start saying stuff and all of a sudden the DM's like, oh, they're headed that way. Oh, okay.
When you talk about, hey, we saw this portrait and this letter said this, you know, that's like a, you know, that's part of the mystery. You got to let that air out a little bit. You're not always going to do it in an RP scene.
Well, all right, so there was a lot of confusion between the wife and the nanny, right? I almost just cleaned my brush and my coffee. Oh my goodness. There was a lot of confusion. So basically the way the specter was described was a woman in a white dress with abdominals, right?
Yeah.
And she was the nanny. She was wearing clothes of a servant, a maid servant. So,
I heard it, but then forgot it.
Yeah, well, that's the thing, right? And then when you found the body in the trunk, it was a woman in a white dress with, you know, a bloody abdomen.
Right.
So, the only thing I say with that is
We got hung up on the doll with the yellow dress a little bit, thinking that they were the same person.
Yeah, fair. I mean, the doll had yellow, but if you the letter that you found, it was mentioned about. I got an assumption it was Gustav, but it was a metathetic server. We know who it is. But he mentions, this is Strahd mentioning that you say you are cursed, but your fortune spent, but you abandon love for madness. You lack solace in the bosom of another woman and sired a stillborn son. So it said it in the letter, what was kind of, hey, there's another woman in play here, and there's basically a bastard child, as they call it. So, and he says, save me for your wretchedness. That's interesting. That's another clue from Strahd. He's mentioning that because he's disgusted by it. FYI. There's a lot of little like layers like that. But you're right. Yeah, I should have probably been clear when you pulled the nanny that it wasn't the lady from the portrait.
No, you were fine. I think the clues were just misinterpreted. That's all. You were fine. Because I understood it. It just got a little misinterpreted.
Oh, good. I bailed it out with the history or the wisdom check from Corgi there that, hey, you're putting this stuff together. I can explain. That, hey, this is a family crib. Now, you're not going to put the nanny in the family crib.
Now, the other issue, well, yeah, right. The other thing
I wouldn't have if that wasn't where she was going to be.
Yeah. The other clue that she was. The other clue that we missed, but Tarnok is the only one who saw it, was the image in the mirror.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
I think that got brazed over real quickly. I just showed that the man and the woman.
But you laid it all out for Tarnok, and he was the only one that saw it and didn't tell the rest of the party.
You're right, I didn't.
But that's fair. That's fair. I mean, who knows? Tarnok may not have thought anything of it.
You're right. And I tried to present it in a way that was quick. It was really a quick vision that you saw in the past. And this campaign is awesome. I'm having a great time on this side of
it. No, it's good. I'm good with it.
Well, good. I'm glad. I really am. Because it is really... It could be dry in some aspects. But I don't... My side of the board is like, man, this is really, really cool. It puts a lot of play into the players to build the story and drive the story out of it. That's what you're really doing. You get used to that dungeon crawl mentality when you deal with the starter sets like Lost Mine, where you're just one kicking one door in and moving to the next dungeon.
And that's what's kind of got Fizz going, is he's used to the whole dungeon crawl aspect, and he's like, look, I don't mind a puzzle or this or that. He goes, but this whole thing is like a giant mystery. I was like, well, that's kind of what it is. The whole campaign is a mystery.
Yeah, man. Okay. All right, guys, I really have to head off. I love the sitting dog.
All right, dude.
Yeah, feel better, man. Yeah. Yeah, I'm going to go hide away. Actually, been pretty good, man. It's been kind of quiet. It's been,
cool.
But, yeah, feel good. Get better, Bully.
Yeah, Bully. I hope you feel better tomorrow.
All right.
You going into work tomorrow, bud?
Yeah, I gotta go in.
All right, guys. Well, I want to end the stream. I'll see you guys on Wednesday. then I'll see Friday for another Curse of Strahd, but Wednesday is basically our lost mine, so I'll see you then. Thanks for everybody for coming out, and I'll see you in the Discords. Bye, guys.